Crime Brewery contains disturbing content related to real-life crimes. Medical information is opinion based on facts of a crime and should not be interpreted as medical advice or treatment. Listener discretion is advised.
I want to talk today about one of my great heroes in medicine, Fred Klenner, who I believe invented intravenous vitamin C. Klenner was a giant of a man intellectually and professionally. But he was a genius. He was just an incredibly brilliant doctor. And he tells a story of the flu epidemic of 1918. And he lived in a small town in Pennsylvania. And in that epidemic, everybody was getting sick and lots of people were dying. It was a very vicious flu. Klenner's family used an herbal tea called Onicet tea. And everybody in his family would drink a cup or more a day. And nobody in his family got sick. Everybody else in town got sick, virtually without exception. And quite a few people died. He remembered this when he went to medical school years later. He found that Bonacet tea, the way they were preparing it, had 5,000 milligrams of vitamin C in it. Now remember, vitamin C recommended daily allowance by the FDA is 50 or 55 milligrams. And he started using vitamin C therapeutically. And he was really genius about it. He used the vitamin C on all sorts of things. And he saved a lot of babies. And he saved a lot of adults with it. And he taught people how to do this. And he taught us at ACAM, American College for Advancement in Medicine, where I was the fourth president. This is the group that has fought for and preserved the use of chelation therapy with EDTA and the use of intravenous vitamin C. And the vitamin C intravenously has been some of the most powerful stuff that I've ever seen.
Welcome to True Crime Brewery. I'm Jill.
And I'm Dick.
Now, before we begin, a reminder about our Design a True Crime Brewery t-shirt contest. We're looking for a cool new t-shirt design from one of our listeners, and there's a $250 prize.
That's true.
Yep.
So. And we've seen some good entries already.
Yeah.
I'm very impressed. There's some I really like.
Yeah.
I'm not telling you which ones.
No, because we still have a long way to go, because the contest goes on until February 1st.
Right, so get those entries in.
Yeah, you can send your entry to us on Instagram, Twitter, or Facebook, or in an email to truecrimebrewery@tiegrabber.com. So what we need from you is a design that shows the heart of what True Crime Brewery is, in a catchy design that looks good on a t-shirt. Doesn't sound like too much to ask, but there's a lot to it.
Well, there is. I mean, it sounds simple.
It does.
But what we're looking for doesn't necessarily have to be simple.
Well, the thing is, the really genius things in life look simple and easy, but they're not, right? A lot of thought goes into it.
Exactly.
Right. So we have big plans for these t-shirts made with this design for a crime con in the spring. And True Crime Brewery isn't for everyone. It's kind of a niche. So we really need someone who understands us to design our t-shirts. And who better than a listener?
See?
Right? So I think that it will be really good. Now we can start our story. So we all have someone in our family who's a little bit unstable.
We certainly do. I can name a few.
Can you? In your own family?
Both our families.
Right. So you could have an eccentric aunt or a brother who's preparing for the zombie apocalypse, maybe. But what happens when a family member sinks deeply into true madness, becoming a danger to himself and to others? This is when interventions are needed or lives can just fall apart. Now, Susie Sharp was born to a prominent Southern family, and she was meant for greatness. Her cousin, Fritz Klenner, was the son of a physician, and he was expected to take over his father's practice. After a bitter divorce, Susie became volatile and paranoid. She was lonely, and her cousin Fritz was there for her. She became involved with Fritz, a college failure who was practicing medicine illegally at that point.
Yeah, he never did go to medical school.
No. Now, he also had a frightening fascination with guns. And he claimed to work for the CIA. So a child custody dispute over Susie's children became bitter as Susie and Fritz isolated themselves from the world outside, and they did everything they could to keep her two young boys from their father. Then relatives began turning up dead, five of them in all. Even as Fritz and Susie were suspected, her children were left in the control of these two dangerous people. Now follow us through this tale of family destruction, beyond what anyone could have predicted. This episode of True Crime Brewery is a stranger than fiction family tragedy, love and madness, murders in a southern family. And what are we drinking while we talk about this?
We are drinking a fine Kentucky beer. It's called Beau and Luke, Dukes of Hazzard.
Nice.
It's brewed by Against the Grain Brewery and Smokehouse in Louisville. Now, Beau and Luke is a Russian Imperial Stout. I'm going to sound like a broken record because I think I've been doing a lot of these lately. But just to remind people, the Russian Imperial Stout is the king, or if you want, queen of stouts. It was originally brewed for the Tsar of Russia to impress him. They tend to be highly alcoholic. They have a roasted, burnt, or chocolate malt aroma, chocolate or coffee taste, dark fruit, and hops are generally pretty quiet. Now, this particular one, Old Beau and Luke, is a chestnut brown color with a frothy tan head that sticks around for a while. It has an aroma of smoked wood, whiskey, and cocoa, and the taste follows the nose quite well. Smoked wood, chocolate, whiskey, a little bit of vanilla. This is a full-bodied beer. The whiskey is kind of prominent, so if you don't particularly care for alcohol, maybe don't go with this one.
Okay, I think most beer drinkers have some enjoyment of alcohol.
Yeah.
To some extent.
You don't want it taking over the whole taste.
Does this do that?
No, I don't think it does, but it's definitely noticeable.
Okay.
It's a good beer.
All right, well, let's open it up. I'm anxious to taste that.
Okay.
Okay, let's take that beer down to the quiet end.
You got it. You know, people are back to normal down there. I was enjoying the costumes from last week.
Yes.
But now it's back to the normalcy.
Okay. Yeah. A little bit drab, honestly, but...
Yeah, but that's us.
That's us. Okay. All right.
Okay, let's start. So the multiple murders in a prominent Southern family began with the romance of Susan Sharp Newsom and Tom Lynch. Now, Susie was a beautiful, intelligent woman who came from one of the most respected families in North Carolina, the Sharp family. Her namesake and aunt, Susan M. Sharp, was the first woman in the whole country to be elected to be the head of a state Supreme Court. Big time
That's
stuff.
Right. She was really an important person in the area. A lot of power, really.
Yes. So she was one of the most respected women in all of America. Now, growing up, Susie was considered to be a spoiled brat by most of the people who met her. Everything had to be her way. Now, as a child, she had such terrible temper tantrums that her mother used to put her in a cold shower to calm her down.
Well, I don't know how appropriate that is.
That's kind of cruel punishment, isn't it?
It seems a little dysfunctional, to be honest with you.
I think so, too.
Yeah.
So Susie went to college at Wake Forest, where she met Tom. Now, Tom came from a prosperous family in Kentucky.
Right, but they were kind of new money, where Susie was old money.
Susie was old money. Tom was new money in the sense that his father had a great job with General Electric.
Yeah.
And had risen through the ranks.
So it was only a couple generations with that family.
Right.
Yeah.
Now, Tom was a pre-med student with a basketball scholarship. I guess he was quite the ball player.
You know, good enough for that, but not anything like he's going to be professional or anything.
No.
No.
And he didn't have any illusions about being a pro basketball player.
I don't think so. I think it was a way to get to college. He wanted to be a doctor, right?
He did. Now, Tom was 2 years younger than Susie, and he was pretty laid back and a good athlete. So it's kind of an opposite from Susie. She certainly wasn't laid back.
No.
And he was handsome, but more importantly to Susie, he is going to be a doctor.
Sure.
Now, I'm thinking there's already some difficulty here, because Susie's an intelligent woman. Why is she just intent on marrying somebody who's going to be a doctor for the status? I mean, I would think she'd be looking to establish her own self.
Well, she did that as well, though. I think she just wanted to be paired up with someone successful.
She certainly did. So Tom, he's pretty flattered by all her attention. I mean, he's a couple of years younger than her, so he's got this hot-looking upperclassman going out with him.
Well, she was beautiful.
She was. And she was also inexperienced at romance, and Tom was her first real boyfriend. And while he seemed nice, his ambitions didn't seem nearly as high as Susie's, and a lot of people wondered if they were a good match.
Yeah, especially those who knew Susie really well. from her side, right?
Right.
Now, when Tom introduced Susie to his mother, Dolores, Dolores didn't care for her. She told her friends that Susie was snooty and pretentious. And after Tom proposed, Dolores tried to talk him out of marrying her. She didn't want Susie in their family, and the dislike was mutual. So the disdain between these two women was obvious from the get-go.
It certainly was. I mean, on the one hand, you figure the mother of the groom, no woman is going to be good enough for her precious son, right?
Some women are that way, yeah.
But still, this seems to be above and beyond that simple stuff.
I think so.
She really loathed Susie.
Well, Susie was kind of snooty, from what we've read and heard about her.
She certainly was.
Now, Tom was in dental school in Kentucky when he and Susie married. They were busy, and they didn't get to spend a lot of time together. In 1974, Susie had a son that they named John. Now, Dolores lived over 2 hours away. She and her daughter, Janie Lynch, came to see the new baby, but Susie actually sent them away after they got there. They had to go to a hotel and wait until Susie said it was okay to come see the baby. So she was not welcoming.
No.
She said that they would need to set up an appointment to see the baby, and they'd have to stay in the hotel. And you can imagine Dolores did not take this well. She was furious.
I think I would be, too. And this is the first grandchild. You're all excited, and you go over, and your daughter-in-law says, sorry.
Yeah.
It's not a good time. Go away.
Right. So Tom was kind of caught between these two strong-willed women trying to make peace. Not easy to do.
No, he found himself constantly trying to do something to make peace between the two of them.
Yeah, and he was kind of laid back, so this was probably, you know, didn't make any sense to him. And he was used to his mother being that way anyway, right?
But, and I don't think he was going to be that effective as a peacemaker.
No, so he kind of married someone who was like his mother in that controlling, kind of domineering way.
Yes, he did.
Now, when their second child, James, was born, it was 1975. And Susie behaved the same way with this child. She felt like her family was above Tom's family, the Lynch family.
Well, you know, Susie's family is Southern gentility.
Right.
And his family is nouveau riche.
Yeah, and not really that riche, because Dolores was very frugal. She'd been poor when she was younger.
Yeah.
And she didn't have, like, great taste or anything. She kind of pocketed her money away. Now, Tom decided to begin his dental practice out west in Albuquerque, New Mexico, and there was a lot of growth out there at the time. A dentist there had invited Tom to join him. Now, Susie, of course, didn't want to go, but this is early in the marriage, and she actually gave in to Tom for once. But she immediately hated it there. She said that it lacked culture and dignity. Now, one of the things might have been that people didn't recognize her family name, and she was treated just like everybody else, which she didn't like.
Oh, that's so horrible.
She wanted to be special.
Yeah, now on the other hand, Tom loved Albuquerque.
Yeah, it's more his scene. He's laid back.
Yeah, it's kind of a Wild West town.
Yeah.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
And he got along well with his colleagues, the Giomini brothers. There were two of them, Armand and Robert. They accepted Tom as a partner in their dental practice. So 6 months after arriving in Albuquerque, Tom and Susie bought a house in the valley near the city's historic district. What do they call it? Old Town?
Old Town. Mm-hmm.
So it's a nice place.
It's very cool out there. I like it. But yes. Within a year, Susie was confiding in a friend that she was totally unhappy.
Yeah, she wanted Tom to go back to North Carolina to practice dentistry. She was complaining that she had no social identity in New Mexico, and regularly dropped into conversations that her aunt was the Chief Justice of the state Supreme Court, and that her uncle Fred Klenner was a world-famous doctor. So she's already trying to play up the
family.
But
she really tries to play herself up on the accomplishments of others in her family, not so much on herself, like you said.
Right, exactly.
Yeah. So Tom and Susie really don't have very much in common once you get down to it. Tom's outdoorsy, loves sports. Susie actually said that athletes were nothing but stupid, sweaty turkeys. Now, by their third year in Albuquerque, none of Tom's friends would visit at the house. Susie was a snob and had no problem being rude to anybody, so Tom's miserable at this point. But he's quiet and tries to avoid confrontations, and he found more reasons to stay away from home. So Susie felt like Dolores should have been giving them some money. As Tom was working to build his practice, they didn't have a lot of money, and they were having trouble making ends meet. But Dolores was cheap, and Dolores wasn't the easiest person in the world either, right?
Dolores was a tough woman.
Yeah.
I can see that. And you've got two very strong-willed women butting heads. And I wouldn't want to be Tom caught in the middle of that.
No. It's not working out very well.
Right. So Susie took a job as a receptionist in 1978 with a company that produced TV commercials. This is to help make ends meet a little bit, because Tom's practice was being built. He wasn't bringing in a lot of money.
Plus, I think Susie wanted to be a career woman.
Well, that's the idea.
Yeah, because she's smart, she's educated. I think she did plan on being a career woman at some point.
She did, but she's had a couple kids.
Right.
Tough to do.
Yeah.
Susie worked her way up with this TV company to a production coordinator, and her bosses liked her, and the extra money that came in certainly was useful to the family, but it didn't make the marriage any better. Tension was a constant in the house. Now, that Christmas in 78, Susie brought the boys home to see her family, leaving Tom behind.
Well, that's not a good sign.
That isn't a good sign. And what did we read? I mean, I guess it was tough for him to get off work or something, but or she just announced that she's going home for Christmas
and taking
the kids.
Yeah, she didn't really want him to go.
Yeah.
Yeah, they were kind of living different lives already, separate lives. Because after she returned home, she was talking about a possible separation.
She was.
She got back from that trip, and she really wasn't invested in the marriage, as they say.
Right.
Now, the babysitter who watched John and Jim while Susie worked was worried about Susie's parenting. She was very controlling, inflexible, which, you know, you can't be with kids. You have to be flexible. And she also favored Jim because she felt like Jim was more like her. John was kind of an unhappy, withdrawn child. As punishment, he'd be forced to stay in his room all day sometimes. And both of the boys began to have some behavior problems, which Susie would just get more and more frustrated.
She did.
So she's kind of butting heads with her own children, too.
Well, I mean, sticking a kid in a room all day for misbehavior isn't the way to address behavior issues.
No, that's, you know, you're just taking away everything.
That's an easy thing to talk about.
It's not good.
And Susie's not a happy woman. She once beat the family dog with a plastic baseball bat right in front of the kids.
Can't imagine that.
And she had no problem spanking the kids when they misbehaved.
Or just outright hitting them.
Or just hitting them.
Yeah.
So one day Tom came home from work and he found John holding his arm in an awkward fashion. He removed John's shirt and saw that the arm looked broken. Now, John said he fell off the bed at the babysitter's. But if Tom had asked the babysitter, he would have learned from her that John had never been on any of the beds at her house. Her husband worked nights and slept all day, so she kept the bedroom shut. So John had been fine when Susie picked him up at the babysitter's. So the implication is that this was some injury caused by Susie.
Had to be, right?
Right.
Yeah.
And the babysitter noticed other signs of abuse. Jim often had red eyes, bloody nose, once had a large lump on his head, which was described the size of a softball.
Right.
Susie, now, that's pretty huge. I don't know about that, but...
Yeah? Well, Susie said she'd take him to the doctor, but she didn't. She pretended to take him to the doctor. The babysitter found that out. Now, Tom saw the lump that evening and was concerned, and he did take Jim to the hospital. And Jim had a concussion and a lot of facial bruising.
Yeah, now how did that happen?
I don't know. I mean, when you get hit in the head, bruising can spread to your face, right?
Sure. After time.
Right. But not the same day?
Probably not the same day.
Well, the doctors were suspicious. They wanted to keep him overnight, and Susie argued with them. The injuries were suspicious, but Tom, he couldn't believe that Susie would have hurt the child. He'd never seen her abuse the children in front of him. Of course, he's never really home.
But he's not home. He's trying to get his practice established.
Yeah, and I think when he wasn't working, he was trying to go play sports and just be away from the house as much as possible.
Right. And you're not going to question your wife, because you can't possibly think that your wife would harm your own child.
Right.
Right?
Well, because she seemed protective of them and possessive of them in another way. So it was kind of a strange situation.
It was.
Jim was admitted to the hospital that time, and he stayed for 2 days, but for some reason, no charges were filed.
Yeah, I mean, this is an interesting thing. I mean, if you think that the kid might have been abused, you're going to call the Department of Social Services, right?
Right.
So I don't know if they never did that, or if they did and they decided that there was no evidence for abuse.
Yeah, it seems like at some point social services did visit the home, but nothing became of it.
Right.
Right. But isn't there a way to tell from a broken arm? There's certain types of breaks that are more likely from abuse.
Oh, certainly.
Want to talk just a little bit about that?
Okay. I mean, the breaks that are more consistent with injury are what are called spiral fractures, like twisting. So you got your arm caught in something. Other kinds of breaks might be more suspicious for abuse. And you're looking also at other sites of injury. So if you have an injury that doesn't sound like it could be accidental, you might do a total body x-ray and you find old fractures that are healing.
Oh, yeah.
Which would certainly be a sign of abuse.
Well, plus the facial bruising he had.
Yeah, I mean, he had a knock on the head.
Yeah.
Facial bruising, broken arm.
Yeah, pretty bad. Now, in the summer of 1979, Susie flew back to North Carolina with the boys to go see her sick grandfather, she said. But a week later, she called Tom and told him that she and the boys weren't going to be coming back. And I guess he wasn't that surprised. Now, she told relatives that Tom had asked her to leave, which Tom said wasn't true. She said he'd had this personality change and he wasn't the same person she'd married. And she said it's possibly a reaction to his blood pressure medication. What do you think of that? Is that a possibility? Doesn't seem like it to me.
Probably not. I mean, I suppose it could be, but there's other side effects that'd be more common. So it's probably something Susie dreamed up as an excuse.
Right. Maybe she was talking to Dr. Klinner, because he had some
right.
unusual ideas.
He had some quackery ideas.
So in September, Susie returned to Albuquerque just to get some of her things. But her mom believed that Susie was hoping to reconcile when she went back. But at this point, Tom was totally checked out of the marriage and he was all business. So Susie returned back to North Carolina like a woman scorned and very angry. Now, Tom actually drove a U-Haul full of her furniture to North Carolina for Susie. And his in-laws, you know, Susie's parents, they liked him. They were very friendly with him.
Yeah.
So that's Bob and Florence Newsom.
Florence.
Yeah.
Right.
Now, he stayed 2 days with them and visited with the boys, so that was good for the boys.
Yeah. And these, her parents or people, or at least her mom, wasn't that in favor of the marriage to begin with.
Well, sure.
But she seems to have softened up her attitude towards Tom.
Well, I think the belief might have been that these two weren't a good match. Not that Tom was a bad person, just that he wasn't the person for Susie.
Right. And I think they're also sensing or already know that their daughter's a piece of work.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, I think you're right. She's starting to not be so right about things. Yeah. She's getting a bit unstable at this point already.
She is. So Tom's mother, Dolores, visited Tom in Albuquerque a few months later. And during this visit, she was surprised to see Tom's attractive dental assistant at the house.
I think she was more than surprised. I think she was a little bit angry about it.
Well, she hadn't had any advance warning or anything.
No, and she was kind of a possessive mother.
Yeah. So apparently after Susie left, Tom started dating Kathy Anderson, and she was his dental assistant working with him for a couple of years. Now, Dolores did not approve of this.
No.
Because he's not even divorced. He's
right.
separated, and he's got a live-in woman. That's not very proper for Dolores.
No, she didn't like it. Susie learned about Kathy from a neighbor. She was angry and said that her boys would never spend time with Tom as long as that woman was there.
That woman.
Right. And she claimed that Tom had been fooling around all along. Now, Susie decided to expand her knowledge of Chinese and go back to graduate school to begin a career in diplomatic service.
Yeah, now, did she do this in school?
She did have an interest in Chinese.
Yeah, she had an interest in the Orient.
Yes, she did. Now, at Guilford College, she found a Chinese tutor, and the tutor told her about the Mandarin Training Center of Taiwan University in Taipei. So she applied and was quickly accepted, and she prepared to move to China for a year. This seems really out of the blue, kind of crazy.
Doesn't it? Yeah.
A little bit crazy.
And it's not just her. She's taking the boys with her.
Well, yeah, that's the part that is worrisome.
I mean, that's something. And Susie's parents thought that was a really shitty idea.
Mm-hmm.
So Susie insisted, and her parents and Tom then begged her to leave the boys with one of them. But she is determined to go ahead and to take the boys with her. So she found an apartment in Taipei for $80 a month and had a lead on a part-time job there.
Well, that's the thing. Susie didn't have much money.
No.
Not at all. She headed off to China with $1,800, some clothing, and a bag full of Star Wars toys for the boys. So she's kind of seeing this as an adventure of a lifetime for them, but they don't really seem prepared for it.
No, I mean, in retrospect, which is always easy.
Yeah.
This was a very unthought-out idea.
Yeah.
And Jesus.
It almost seems like she had a bit of mania.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I mean, you'd start thinking maybe some mental health issues.
Sure.
To be insisting on, I mean, not just moving, but moving overseas to a country where nobody speaks your language.
And you don't have much
and
resources.
You don't have any money or resources.
The only person she knew there was her tutor's family.
I mean, geez.
Plus taking those little kids. That's tough. So they did stay with the tutor's family for a few days while she found some child care and set up her little apartment. So this apartment was new, but it was extremely small. It was a fourth floor walk up on a narrow alley. It was a working class area, so there's no luxuries. Now, Susie Sharp is used to the best.
That's right.
So I'm shocked she's willing to do this.
She's a Sharp from North Carolina.
I know. I mean, I almost give her credit that she was willing to go without like that, because I wouldn't have thought she would have it in her.
No, that's for sure. But again, I just keep coming back to, man, you should have planned better.
Of course. It was very sudden, and yeah. So she had to share this apartment with a landlady, too. So she and the boys have two small bedrooms, and they share a bath and the kitchen. Classes began just a few days after they arrived, and she was struggling to learn, you know, how to manage her life there, to learn bus schedules, and to even know the geography of the neighborhood.
Yeah.
Stressful.
Yeah. So, yeah. I mean, pretty quickly she figured out that she'd made a big mistake.
I think she did, yeah.
And she felt kind of guilty for putting the boys in this position. They stayed there for 6 months before they came back home. Boys were dirty and malnourished, and Susie was quite disillusioned.
Yeah, Susie's mother, Florence, was really shocked to see Susie's condition when they returned. And Susie decided she was going to see the doctor in the family, Dr. Fred Klinner. Now, his office was in a very unlikely spot. The narrow front entrance was situated between a beauty shop and a local TV station. There was a hand-painted sign reading Fred R. Klinner, Diseases of the Chest, Limited General Practice. So doorways led to separate waiting rooms for blacks and whites, which is something that he maintained well into the 1980s.
When integration had been long ago introduced.
He was very racist.
Oh, no kidding.
Now, two walls were covered with official-looking certificates and diplomas. He was a smart and educated man in that respect. But kind of a nutso, right? Kind of a...
Kind of.
Is there a better way to say that?
But she went to see him because he was married to one of her aunts.
Mm-hmm.
So this is their, like, family doctor.
Right. It's her uncle.
Yeah.
So the furnishings were very masculine. There were a lot of antiques around. But it was super cluttered. There were old medical instruments, and there's this big vintage Bible. And very strangely, he had hung two hornet's nests as decoration from old pipes on the ceiling.
Yeah, he had a real eclectic mix of decor.
He sure did. That's a nice way to put it.
And there was just an absolutely astounding amount of clutter in his office and in his home, and as it turns out, in Fritz's home.
Yes.
But there was a lot of clutter. Files of medicine there looked older than the doctor. And he had a huge red, white, and blue George Wallace for President poster and gun magazines scattered all over on the tables.
Yeah, well, depending on who you asked, Dr. Klinner was either one of the most cutting-edge physicians or a huge quack. So he graduated from Duke Medical School. In the 1940s, he began experimenting with ascorbic acid, vitamin C. He saw it as a treatment for a wide variety of illnesses. He used vitamin C on everything from toothaches to polio, and he claimed to have cured people. Now, anyone who came to his office could expect to be given a shot of vitamin C right off. And one of the most cringeworthy things about Dr. Klinner was that he still used a needle sterilizer And this is in the time of the AIDS epidemic.
Yeah.
Pretty so scary.
Irresponsible.
He also claimed to know the exact date that the world would end.
Yes, that's an important thing to know, so you can prepare for it.
Well, and he was preparing for it. We'll find out.
Certainly was.
Yes.
So he had a son who was Fritz. His name was still Fred, Frederick, like his father, but everybody called him Fritz.
That's right.
And Fritz made the rounds at Annie Penn Hospital in Reidsville with Dr. Klenner. He wore a white doctor's coat and said he was in med school at Duke. Dr. Klenner would take blood samples, hand them off to Fritz, who was apparently doing research as part of his studies at Duke, which was his father's school, medical school.
Yes.
So Fritz was seen as an up-and-coming protege of his illustrious father. Only one small problem. Fritz wasn't actually in medical school.
He hadn't even graduated college.
He hadn't. But his father would be very disappointed, and Fritz, who adored his father, would do anything to please him.
Well, yeah, there's some real pathology in that family.
Oh, isn't there?
Yeah. So part of his mental illness is this fear of disappointing or being rejected by his father. I mean, that's a huge thing to him, right? He graduated from a private high school in Georgia, and he studied at the University of Mississippi. But contrary to what he would say, he never graduated there. He told his family that he had, and he claimed that enemies at the college were withholding his degree, but it would be straightened out and he would be attending Duke Medical School. So for years, people believed that Fritz was studying to be a doctor. He also told people he was a Green Beret and that he did undercover work for the CIA. Now, Fritz had an arsenal of guns and thousands of rounds of ammunition. So Susie goes to see Dr. Klenner, and he diagnoses her with multiple sclerosis. And I don't think there was anything done other than a blood test and looking her over. And seems like a very quick diagnosis to me. A little premature, maybe.
Quite probably.
Yeah.
I mean, there is no specific test to diagnose multiple sclerosis. But you can do testing to rule out other things. And if the symptoms fit, it's most likely MS. But it would be difficult, and if not impossible, to see a patient one time and say, oh, you have MS.
Well, not only did he know what she had, but he had the cure for it.
He did.
So Fritz gave her some vitamin C injections. Now, they're cousins, Susie and Fritz. And they became close friends at this point, and soon after, they would become lovers.
They are first cousins.
Yes. Susie began to see herself, Fritz, and the boys as a family. After all, she reasoned, royal families in Europe had practiced incest to keep their bloodlines pure, so there really shouldn't be a problem with this.
Of course not.
Although they did try and keep it secret.
Well, they must have sensed some problem with it, because they didn't want the whole world to know that they were together.
Well, in a way they didn't, but then in other ways, it was quite obvious. They didn't hide it well.
No, they did a very poor job.
Yeah. So when Susie's parents finally figured out that Susie and Fritz were lovers, they were, of course, upset. There was an argument, and Susie and the boys had been living with them. So there's this confrontation, and Susie leaves the house, taking the boys with her. So Florence and Bob, Susie's dad, are pretty upset. And they feel like Fritz has brainwashed her. She's not the Susie they knew. I mean, Susie was always a little uptight and tense, but this Susie's really kind of almost batshit crazy.
She is, because she's convinced that Tom's dentist colleagues were part of an organized crime ring, and Tom was involved in this.
Well, Fritz was telling her this, I believe.
She thought that Tom was going to try to take the boys away from her. So in response to these fears, she limited Tom's contact with the boys even more. So she's getting more kind of paranoid about things, and probably encouraged by Fritz. Any phone calls from Tom to the boys were monitored, and they were kept brief. Any letters or packages that Tom or Grandma Dolores sent were thrown away without the boys seeing them. And she was very successful, Susie was, in making Tom jump through hoops to see his boys. So some people suggested that Susie's aunt, who is the Supreme Court judge, or former judge, was influencing things. Tom had to provide airfare for Susie to accompany John and Jim to Albuquerque, because they're too young to fly alone. The agreement he signed allowed him only holiday visits in 4 weeks each summer. So that's not joint custody, and by any means, is it?
No, but I'm thinking 1980s joint custody wasn't as common as it is today. Moms usually had custody.
Yeah, but still.
And I think Tom was okay.
Holidays in 4 weeks?
He was okay with her having custody, but yeah, he wanted to definitely see them more than that.
Yeah.
That's crazy. That's not nearly enough to maintain a relationship with them.
So, and by this time, they are actually divorced, and Tom married Kathy. And when the boys came on their rare visits, they stayed with Tom and his new wife, Kathy.
Sure.
So whenever they picked up the boys at the airport, they were always shocked at how bad the boys looked. Underweight, dirty hair, unclipped nails, just unkempt.
Yeah, and then they always had these big, large plastic bags of vitamins with them.
That's right, because those are going to take care of you.
So that was, they weren't liking that. Well, at least Tom wasn't liking that at all. Because, I mean, they weren't labeled. He didn't know what these pills were. And the kids were taking like 20 to 40 of them a day.
Taking a bunch.
Huge amounts.
So in May 1984, Fritz's father, Fred, was rushed to the hospital with a stroke, and he died there.
Yes.
So now Fritz is going to take over the practice.
Well, he can't, though.
Except that he's not a physician.
Right. So on June 24th, Dolores Lynch was found dead outside of her home, and she'd been shot in the back and in the head. Her body had been there for over 24 hours, and there was a trail of blood, and when investigators followed it into the house, they found 39-year-old Janie, who's Tom's sister, shot in her back and her head. So these are two murders in a very small town. It's not a place where this normally happens.
Murders never happen in this place.
Right. So it seems like Dolores had come home from church and just been shot on her way into the house. And Janie had been shot and ran for her life and was shot inside the house. And then no one discovered them for over a day.
Right. So Dolores is lying outside in all the heat.
Oh. Terrible.
Ugh.
This was shocking to the community, and it kind of looked like a professional hit because they were just shot and killed. There didn't seem to be a robbery. Now, Dolores is sprawled on her left side by the garage, and the top of her head and the left side of her face were pretty much gone. So you can imagine that this was disgusting. It was the most grotesque sight Police Chief Steve Nobles had ever seen. You can imagine it was very hot outside, and there's a horrible smell of death.
I can only imagine.
So inside the house is air conditioning, thank goodness, and there were two drops of blood near the kitchen counter. The burglar alarm was shut off. In an upstairs bedroom, a jewelry box was turned upside down, and the contents of Janie's purse were spilled out on the bed. Janie lay face down on a small rug in the sunroom. Now this room adjoined Dolores' bedroom. And the black and white top she wore had been torn by a bullet that struck her in the back by her right shoulder blade. Her hair was up in curlers, and one of the curlers was actually driven into her skull by a bullet. And no weapon was found on the premises. So as time passed, the mystery of who had killed Dolores and Janie went unsolved. During a follow-up visit to the house, several palm leaves were found arranged in crosses on the floor. And this is a mystery that's never been explained.
Right, but what I can explain is math. How's your child doing in math? Whether they need to get caught up or want to get ahead, Mathnasium is there to help. We are a big math family. Three of our children work in math-related fields, and we have a good understanding of the importance of math, not only in one's occupation, but also in day-to-day life. Mathnasium is a leading math-only learning center, where caring, qualified instructors help kids master the math skills they need to build confidence at school, improve test scores, open options for their future, and change their lives forever. Make tiers and homework battles a thing of the past. I vote for that.
I do. I remember those days.
Yes. Because at Mathnasium, they don't just help kids understand math, they help kids enjoy math. Now, I can't tell you how many kids I see in my day-to-day practice that say they don't like math. So any program that turns kids into math enthusiasts is a great idea. Your child's learning journey can start today. Why delay such an important decision? So visit mathnasium.com/offers/brewery to learn more about their program and to download the ebook every parent needs, Helping Children Excel at Math. That's mathnasium.com/offers/brewery.
Okay. Now, John and Jim were visiting Tom in Albuquerque when Tom was notified that his mother and sister had been murdered. He asked Susie if the boys could stay on with him a few days as he grieved this loss, but she said absolutely not.
Yeah. Nice empathy there, huh?
Right. Now, Susie's mother, Florence, called Tom with condolences, and he was very appreciative of her kindness. He took this opportunity to share with her his frustrations about not being able to see the boys as much as he should. He was concerned for their well-being, and he missed them. Now, Florence agreed with Tom that it is important for boys to maintain a strong relationship with their father, as well as their mother. Now, she and Susie's father, Bob, were worried about the boys, too, and they started to keep in contact with Tom.
Yeah, now, meanwhile, Tom doesn't realize that Susie and Fritz are referring to each other as husband and wife.
Not at all.
And the boys were calling Fritz Papa. Boy, that pissed me off.
Well, more than piss you off, it's worrisome. These are crazy people. I mean,
they're disturbed people. Descending into madness.
Yes.
So Fritz had moved many of his things into Susie's two-bedroom apartment. Susie's almost done with her master's degree in business administration, and Fritz is continuing to treat people and present himself as a doctor. He's up all night, sleeping through most of the day. Neighbors assume that he worked at a late shift at the hospital and thought that he and Susie were married.
And during this time, he was continuing to offer medical advice to neighbors and strangers. He told one neighbor that he had taken over his father's clinic, which wasn't true. He was constantly moving military equipment and weapons in and out of this apartment with his Chevy Blazer. He was seen loading this gear into the Blazer in the middle of the night sometimes. He had more than normal caution about intruders, and he'd rigged the apartment with homemade burglar alarms and locks. He had the
front doors rigged so that if somebody broke in, they'd get a tear gas canister or
something like that.
Just weird.
Yeah. He also spoke knowledgeably about these explosives, and he was able to convince a Vietnam vet in his neighborhood that he had also served in that war. So he could be convincing, I guess. Now, Tom and Kathy flew to Greensboro the first week of November for a 5-day visit. Tom rented an apartment so they'd have a nice place to visit with the boys. He'd given Susie 2 weeks' notice as required by the court, but she was still hostile when he went to pick up the boys. Susie looked like she was coming unraveled. She was disheveled, wide-eyed. She'd always been so meticulous about her looks, and it was shocking for Tom to see her that way.
Yeah, it was.
She'd been a beautiful young woman.
And she's chopped her hair, and she's just clearly on the downhill side.
Yes. It's a very dysfunctional household.
So that same night, Susie called her brother Rob and said she needed to speak with him. So they met in Rob's office, talked for a couple hours. And according to Rob, Susie was afraid and distressed. She's afraid of Tom. She's said that Tom had criminal associations and he was dealing drugs. She never left the house without her pistol and her dogs, two chows, My Ling and Maisie. Chows can be kind of vicious.
They can be, yeah.
They're very protective.
Right.
Susie also showed Rob her .25 caliber Browning semi-automatic pistol. And she also said that Fritz was an employee of the CIA. And when Rob asked about her relationship with Fritz, Susie hedges, saying that he's just visiting often to make sure she and the boys are safe.
Now, Rob wasn't believing what she was saying about Tom or Fritz. His initial thought, actually, was that he should have her committed. He remembered that his mother's cousin had gone off the deep end, and she had killed her estranged husband and herself. He wondered if this mental illness ran in the family, which it very well could have.
Yeah, but he didn't follow up on this.
He didn't. He was concerned, though, and he called their parents, Florence and Bob, and he told his father about the conversation and that he thought Susie was really out of control and irrational. He felt like his dad had just thought he was exaggerating. But Florence had taken this very seriously, and she went ahead. She called Tom and Kathy and asked to meet with them that evening, because he's in town at this point.
Right. Now, Tom's quite surprised about some of the things that he was told.
Well, he didn't know about this stuff, of course.
No.
He's across the country.
Yeah, he's in Albuquerque.
Right.
There in North Carolina.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody thought that Susie was almost pathologically possessive of the kids. and they didn't know what the relationship was between Susie and Fritz, but wondered if they were living together. Now, Tom had already asked the boys this, and they said that Fritz usually spent the night in the apartment. Obviously, Tom doesn't like that idea. And he didn't like the way the boys looked. They had long fingernails and toenails. Hair was long, dirty. They just looked neglected. Monday, at the end of their visit, Tom and Kathy ate lunch with the boys at their school. John's teacher told Tom that he'd been crying all morning because Tom was leaving. And John cried when Tom took him back to Susie.
Yeah, so they got back to the apartment. Tom asked if the boys could show their dad their room, but Susie made it clear to him that he was not going to come inside that apartment.
Not any way.
So in mid-December, Kathy wrote to Bob in Florence, and she wrote that she and Tom had hoped to see the boys over Christmas. They had mailed gifts to them, but felt unsure if Susie would give them to them. And she was concerned about her husband, Tom. He'd just lost his mother and sister in that double murder, and now he was very worried for the well-being of his two sons, and rightly so. Now, the boys were very secretive on the phone, and they were getting conflicting stories from them. Tom was afraid that Fritz was going to kill the boys with his doctoring.
Yeah, because he's plying them with vitamins, he's giving them shots.
Yeah.
There was one occasion where he had cut off moles or something on their faces.
Oh, Jesus.
I mean, Fritz is nuts.
Yeah, he is.
No one in the family realized that Susie and Fritz were calling each other husband and wife. They were keeping that a secret.
Yeah, but around their neighbors they did, right? They told them.
The neighbors all assumed they were married. But they were pretty much loners. They kept to themselves.
Well, that doesn't surprise me, considering what's going on there.
Right. I mean, we're descending more and more into paranoia, and they're just not being open with anybody.
Right, right.
So Fritz referred to Susie as his wife and the boys as his sons whenever they were out socially. And he asked the boys to call him Papa.
Now, Susie's apartment is starting to resemble the Klinner house at this point. It's cluttered and dirty. Camouflage sheets were hung over all the windows, so it's dark. And Fritz slept most of the day, as Susie did continue to attend classes and do well, getting her master's degree in business administration.
She was doing quite well in school from what we read.
She's a smart woman. Yeah.
She's a very intelligent woman.
But he's still presenting himself as a doctor and offering medical advice to strangers. Now, Fritz was a regular customer at the local Kroger store, which was open 24 hours, and he usually shopped there after midnight. He was wearing camouflage fatigues or a doctor's coat with a stethoscope in the pocket. Now, he often spent time on the payphone out front. He bought rubbing alcohol, boxes of gauze and medical tape, and massive amounts of vitamins. Now, one night, Fritz became agitated when the total of the customer in front of him came to $6.66.
Oh, the mark of the beast.
That made him really upset, right?
Well, yeah, Armageddon is here.
Right. So people at Kroger are starting to wonder, is this guy really a doctor? And why is he buying all these vitamins and medical supplies here at the grocery store? And now he's freaking out over the 666.
That is true.
So he said that those numbers represented the mark of the beast, and he started talking then about the Battle of Armageddon. He actually said, "Before I'll take the mark of the beast, I'll take my wife and two children, and we'll go so far back in the mountains that not even the devil can find us."
This is nuts.
Now, in the late fall, Fritz began to go to the Army surplus store about once a week or even more, and he told the owner that he'd taken over his father's medical practice. Now he bought knives, canteens, sleeping bags, food rations, and camouflage material. He never looked at the prices, so price was no object, I guess. And he bought books, mostly military manuals, on explosives, survivalism, and killing techniques. And he always paid cash.
He did.
Now where was he getting the money?
Well, he got about $25,000 insurance money when his father died. But by the spring of 1985, he only had about $1,000 left. So he's been spending money.
Yeah.
He never missed a gun show. And he also bought weapons by mail order. And on the black market, he bought stolen military grenades, mines, and other explosives. So Fritz is convinced that Armageddon would be set off by a nuclear explosion that would result in panic and civil disorder. And he wanted to be prepared.
So this is something he probably picked up from his father. Because he seemed to have similar beliefs.
Yeah, they're both crazy about that.
And what about his mother, the doctor's widow?
She was a pretty passive woman. I don't think she had much to do with it.
Yeah, she kind of went along with whatever the doctor said, right?
Yeah, she called him the doctor.
Yeah, kind of like around our house.
Yeah.
That's how things go.
Well, that's because I insist on it.
Well, of course. Now, in March, Tom and Kathy took the boys to Disneyland, and Tom talked about spending more time with them. He's excited to be getting more involved in their lives as they're getting older. Now, on the trip, though, John acted like something was bothering him, but he wouldn't talk to them about it. He cried all the way back to the airport because he didn't want to return to his mother. Now, Tom and Kathy explained that they would have more time with him, but they had to go through the courts and do everything the right way. And this is a topic in this story that comes to my mind, especially about following the rules of the court. So Tom tried to do everything right with custody.
He did. And everything he did was through his attorney.
Right.
He wasn't trying to kidnap the boys or take them away or do anything.
No. And things ended disastrously.
Yeah.
So it just makes you wonder. I mean, after everything happened, Tom questioned whether he should have been more aggressive.
Well, sure. I mean, that's... You've lost your two children.
Let's not give it away.
Okay, back that up.
Now, after Tom dropped the boys at the airport on that trip, he called Susie's father, Bob Newsom, and he told him that he was going to be going back to court because he wanted to get more visitation with the boys. He asked Bob to testify on his behalf. So Bob had no problem with that.
Right, and this is Susie's father.
Yes.
So he's ready to testify that his son-in-law or ex-son-in-law should be granted more visitation.
Right. But he's still not asking for total custody of the boys.
No.
And Bob has some genuine concerns about the boys with Susie, and now they know she's with Fritz, so they're worried. Because even when Susie came back and went to see Dr. Klinner after going to China, the parents didn't believe in Dr. Klinner. They thought he was a quack, and they tried to tell her. But she thought he was a prestigious physician.
She did.
I mean, your belief was either one way or the other with him, I guess. He was either brilliant or wacko. And there wasn't much of a gray area.
Well, I think he could be a brilliant wacko.
Yeah, and that's probably what he was. So on May 2nd, a motion was filed for extended visitation, and they set up a hearing for May 23rd. So Tom called Bob to let him know, you know, expect a subpoena, and you can testify in the hearing. So Bob got the subpoena the week before the hearing. And he visited Susie. He was really dreading it, but he visited her to tell her that he was going to be testifying and just explain to her why he was doing it. Of course, she saw this as a complete betrayal because she's his daughter and he should be on her side.
He's not supposed to take sides like this.
Right. Well, if he takes a side, it should be her side.
Yes.
So that afternoon, Susie showed up at her lawyer's office and she had two of the boys' stuffed animals with her. She's crying and visibly shaking as she shows him these stuffed animals' throats were slashed. Now, after she found them in her apartment, she said she received an anonymous call saying, two down, two to go. So she took this to mean that the murders of Janie and Dolores were the first two down, and the two to go were her sons, John and Jim. I don't know why that's what she decided it meant, but... Well, I really feel like Fritz had a lot to do with this.
Fritz's hand is all over this.
He's feeding her a lot of bogus information, paranoid information.
He is. On the evening of May 19th, 1985, Susie's parents, Bob and Florence, and her grandmother, Hattie, were shot to death in Hattie's home in Winston-Salem. Rob called Susie's phone several times to tell her that. Rob's her brother.
Mm-hmm.
And he called several times and she didn't answer. A little after midnight, a dentist who lived in the neighborhood and was a close family friend finally reached Susie. She said she had just gotten home from a trip. Now, the neighbors told Susie that there had been an accident at the house, but she didn't ask any questions.
No, because she probably knew what had happened, right?
Well, yeah, that's the idea.
Right.
A short time later, Rob's wife, Alice, called her to tell her that they were all dead. Now, Alice would remember that Susie didn't cry or scream or seem shocked. Silence on the phone, Susie finally said, well, there's nothing left, is there?
So how do you interpret that? To me, that's a very poignant statement.
Well, I think it indicates to me that she knew what was going on.
Sure.
Or what had happened.
Does it indicate to you hopelessness, like everything's gone bad, everything's coming to an end? Kind of like a fatalist view?
There's nothing left.
Right. That's how I took it. Like there's nothing left in a very broad sense of the word.
Yeah. That's a big warning sign, right?
Absolutely.
But nobody picked up on it.
No, they just thought, well, she's very unemotional about her parents and her grandmother being killed. That's very odd.
Yeah.
So Tom learned about these murders from his attorney, and after talking to Rob, Susie's brother, he was absolutely certain that Fritz and Susie were involved. And this made him think, you know, well, they're probably involved in my mother and my sister's murder as well. So he called the Kentucky State Police detective, who's handling the murders of Dolores and Janie, and tells him about these other murders that had happened and how he thinks that Susie and Fritz were probably involved in this. So investigators in Kentucky and North Carolina are very interested in Susie Lynch and Fritz Klinner at this point.
They certainly are. And if you look at things in the aftermath, maybe they were a little late in getting interested in Susie and Fritz.
Yes, I believe so.
So Susie and her brother Rob make funeral plans for parents and grandparent. Rob realizes that something wasn't quite right about Susie.
Well, he'd kind of been known that, right? Because she'd come to him before with the gun and all her paranoid thoughts.
Yeah.
So it couldn't have been a complete surprise to him that something's wrong with her.
I mean, I think it's just kind of confirming what he thought he already knew.
And it's probably getting worse.
Certainly. So Susie's pretty detached. She's without emotion. And this is after the deaths of parents and grandmother.
Right.
She went to the house with Rob to look for some items. Officers went with them. Susie doesn't ask any questions about the investigation in terms of, you know, have you figured out who killed my parents?
Yeah.
Any of that. But she did ask about her grandmother's will.
So that seems terribly inappropriate.
Doesn't it?
Now, Rob confided to a friend his suspicions about Susie and Fritz. But he didn't reveal them to the police. He's still feeling kind of loyal to her. It's his sister. When asked if anybody in the family had an unusual interest in weapons, though, Rob did bring up Fritz. And when police questioned Susie, they actually found her to be quite charming and bubbly, as if they were just having a friendly lunch together or getting together for tea. But they went into the apartment and they found it extremely cluttered. Fritz was sitting on the couch, and she said, "This is my cousin Fritz. He just helps us out."
Uh-huh. So Susie had to move books and papers to even make space for the detectives to sit down.
This is identical to the house that Fritz grew up in.
No kidding.
And the medical office of Dr. Klinner.
Exactly. So the detectives are trying to be friendly, but Fritz isn't opening up at all. He's not talking. He just sat there watching, and Susie's making small talk.
Yeah.
So they ask about the murder. Susie showed the most concern over the condition of the family home. She's worried that the fingerprint test would damage things. And she also asked about the whereabouts of her grandmother's silver, jewelry, and mink coat.
Right, so she's thinking about what she's going to inherit and trying to keep things in good condition, but not really showing any concern about the loss of these people or who did it.
Exactly.
So during this investigation, detectives found a young man named Ian Perkins, and he was a friend of Fritz's who lived in Reidsville. Ian was only 21. He was a student at Washington and Lee University in Lexington, Virginia at this point. Detectives questioned him, and after a small amount of interrogation, Ian recounted what had happened on the night of the Newsom's murders.
Right, and here's where things start opening up.
Right. So Fritz Klinner had confided in Ian that he worked for the CIA. And Ian, who's younger, was impressed with this, and he did share an interest in anti-communism and guns with Fritz. So Ian said that Fritz had an assignment to wipe out a communist cell, and he had invited Ian to help. Communists were apparently smuggling weapons to South America and trading them for drugs. The profits were going to help the cause of communism. So Fritz told Ian if he helped him in this covert operation, that it would really look good on his record when Ian was officially recruited to the CIA after he completed college.
Right,
so he's really roped this guy in.
Yeah, and Ian was into that. He wanted to be part of the CIA.
He did.
So Fritz is feeding him this line of bullshit about how you work with me and this will reflect well on your future application.
Right. And Ian respects Fritz. He thinks that he's a doctor, a CIA operative, a Green Beret. He's buying all this.
Well, sure.
He's kind of naive.
To say the least.
Yeah. So Fritz planned for the two of them to have a 3-day weekend, telling people they were camping in the Blue Ridge Mountains and this was going to be their alibi. Not so smart, really.
Not the greatest of alibis.
No.
So at 11 o'clock Saturday, Ian drops Fritz off in Winston-Salem, which was just a half mile from where Bob Florence and Hattie were. An hour later, Ian picked Fritz up, and Fritz tells him that the mission had been a success. The detectives, though, told Ian that Fritz wasn't a doctor, never worked with the CIA, and probably murdered these people. So Ian, trying to save himself and to help out, because he's, I think, at the heart of things, an honorable person.
Yeah, I don't think he wanted anyone to be murdered.
So he agrees to wear a wire and talk to Fritz and see if he can get Fritz to confess things.
But apparently he was a nervous wreck with this. He wasn't that good at it.
Well, I don't think I'd be very good at that.
Yeah, yeah. Fritz is a scary guy.
This is a civilian.
Yeah.
So Ian told Fritz that the police had been asking him about the Newsoms. Fritz continues to insist that he works for the CIA, and he gave Ian some pills that he said would calm his nerves during interviews with the police. Now, Ian met with Fritz 3 times, and at no time did Fritz ever admit to killing the Newsoms. He told Ian he wouldn't see him again after the 3rd meeting.
So
it sounds like Fritz has some plans.
Yeah, so the police didn't really get what they wanted.
No.
At this point, they feel like they have enough that they are going to move forward.
Yeah, I think so.
Now, Susie gave a rundown of the weekend to police when they questioned her. She said she had dinner at Annie Hill's home in Reidsville on Friday night. Annie Hill is Dr. Klinner's widow. Fritz had gone camping in the mountains, and she spent Saturday at a friend's house. Then she took the boys to McDonald's before she went home. On Sunday afternoon, she said, Fritz called from Lexington, Virginia, and asked her to meet him at the Natural Bridge restaurant for dinner. Now, she drove there with the boys, a 4-hour trip. They ate in the cafeteria, took a short hike, and then drove all the way back to Greensboro, arriving back at 11:30. So none of this makes sense to me. Why would anyone do this?
I mean, this is a way out of the way trip. Hi, why don't you come have me, join me for dinner?
And do 8 hours of driving.
By the way, it's just a few hours each way.
Now, as soon as they got back to their apartment, according to Susie, one of their chows ran off after a cat, and Fritz had to spend 4 hours looking for the dog. So he was busy doing that. Now, when police asked Susie if she knew anything about the Lynch murders in Kentucky, she was very eager to talk about that. She had some opinions. She said it was a professional hit, and that Tom was involved in some shady dealings, she said, and he probably owed money to the murderers. And the murderers would know that Dolores Lynch left a large estate behind, which Tom would inherit. She also said to them right out front, she said she was trying to get some of that money from the inheritance for her boys.
Yeah, she wasn't shy about that.
No, she'd been talking to anyone who would listen about that. So as they're talking to Susie, police are noticing the clutter in the apartment. Behind a screen separating the living room from the dining room, they notice a big pile of military gear. And as they left, they notice that the front door was rigged with a motion detector. There was a big floodlight and a strobe light aimed at the door, I guess to blind people. And there was a grenade fastened above the door.
Yeah, this is just nuts.
It really is, and I don't see why at this point they didn't arrest him. And this is something I'm kind of critical about police about, why they waited so long.
Well, and I think the Kentucky police are critical of them also.
I mean, there must be some law against having a grenade like that.
Yeah.
You think they could have arrested him on some smaller charge just to get him put in jail while they figure things out, right?
Right.
That's how I would see it. Mm-hmm.
So May 28th, detectives come to Susie's apartment without announcing themselves.
Mm-hmm.
They ask to see Fritz. She lets them in. She gets Fritz. He comes into the living room wearing a 1-piece green flight suit, sort of military stuff, right?
Uh-huh.
So the detectives asked Fritz if he would mind coming to the SBI office for an interview, and he agreed. He changed into khakis and a polo shirt. Well, that's a little more appropriate. However, he had a sheathed knife on his belt and a flashlight in his back pocket.
This is the middle of the day. Why does he need to pop a flashlight into his pocket before he leaves?
So they get him down to police headquarters, and the first thing they ask is why he wasn't licensed in the state if he was a physician. So Fritz finally has to tell them that he might have trained as a physician, but he had no formal degree. He went over his activities on the weekend of the Newsom murders, saying he got to the mountain, couldn't find Ian, talked to a park ranger, called his mother. Ian's mother told him that Ian had gone back to Lexington. So Fritz drove there, arriving at midnight. Then they drove together to the Blue Ridge Parkway, came to a campground, set up camp, slept until 2 p.m., went out for lunch. This is all a nice alibi.
Very detailed. You have to give him that.
After that, they made a fire, set out for a night hike.
Yeah, night hike. I've never heard of that.
Me either. They left for the hike around 8 o'clock, got back to the campsite around midnight. And at noon the next day, they broke camp. Now, Fritz told the same story that Susie had about meeting up with her and the boys, returning to the apartment, with the dog running off and his looking for the dog for 4 hours. Now, this didn't match what Ian told them.
No. No, not at all. So, June 3rd, a few more days go by, and after tracking Fritz for several days, police are finally ready to arrest him. Now, first they called the apartment and asked Susie if Fritz was there, and she lied and said that he was out. They didn't want to risk a shootout at the apartment, so they waited, and about 2:30, Susie and Fritz were seen loading things into Fritz's Chevy Blazer. They saw Fritz carrying what looked like military weapons as Susie carried duffel bags. Then they were surprised and alarmed when they saw that John and Jim were with them. They came out of the apartment building wearing camouflage. Now, I guess the police had thought the boys were in school. Why they didn't check this beforehand, I don't know.
It would seem to be an easy thing to check, right?
Yeah, and even 2:30 in the afternoon, a lot of kids are coming home from school.
That's true.
So this doesn't seem like they were that careful about it, as they could have been.
Well, yeah, again, in retrospect, it's something they should have ascertained.
Yeah, I would think so.
So the boys climb into the Blazer with the dogs and Susie. She gets into the passenger seat. Fritz is the last one out of the apartment, backs the Blazer out of the parking space and drives off. Now, this Blazer was retrofitted with a bunch of stuff. He had huge tires, roll bars, custom bumpers.
Quite ominous looking.
They had it equipped for nighttime missions with 7 headlights across the front that would put out a 180-degree beam of light for long distances. So this is a truck that's going to go through all sorts of stuff.
It's going to get them through Armageddon.
Right.
Now, police cars followed the Blazer and began to close in on them. Now, although they didn't like taking Fritz with the boys in the car, now they had the worry that if they let him go with the boys could be killed. So now they're kind of in a position to make this decision, and they decide to go ahead. They tried to block him off, but Fritz drove up on the curb and slowly and deliberately kept driving away. He didn't speed off. Now, he was seen with his left arm propped in the open window. His arm in the window lowered then, and a police car pulled up beside him, and the policeman was quite, you know, disconcerted to see that he was holding a submachine gun.
Yeah, that would get your attention, wouldn't it?
It sure would.
And it's pointing at you?
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
So then he reached for his pistol at the same time, and the police car was hit with 5 bullets right away, and one hit the officer's bulletproof vest, the other deflected off his belt buckle. Now, this car skid to the side of the road, but 6 more cars were still following Fritz. Police on the scene would say that Fritz was smiling throughout this whole chase. He had some kind of weird smile on his face.
Well, like he was enjoying it.
Yeah, this is what he'd been, you know, planning for a while.
So bullets are flying all over the place on these roads and intersections.
Yeah, and pedestrians are taking cover.
Yeah. And every time they thought they had Fritz boxed in, he backed up, he hit cars, he maneuvered past a college campus, all the while continuing to shoot at police.
So this is an amazing thing, right? This is something you usually would only see in the movies.
Yeah, this is a movie scene, right?
I think even the police are stunned that this is happening. This just isn't the kind of thing that happens.
No. So one time Fritz stops right in the middle of the road and shoots at police. So the chase leaves Greensboro, and Fritz is continuing north to US 220. And the police figured that he is headed for the farm that he and his father, or he and his parents, had near Eden, North Carolina. This place was stocked with weapons and survivalist materials. So suddenly the Blazers stopped on the road again. The police are pursuing them, but not really. They're just kind of staying in the background.
It's kind of like the OJ thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. So they're following him, but, you know, they don't want to do anything too aggressive because the children are
right,
in the
they
car.
They got the kids in the car.
But then they don't feel safe letting him go with the kids either,
right.
So.
So suddenly the Blazer stops. There's two shots that the police could hear in the cab of the Blazer, and then it blows up.
Huge explosion.
Holy shit.
Yeah. Giant explosion. And with this explosion, the Blazer lifts off the ground as high as a nearby telephone pole and comes slamming down to the ground. So this happened at 3:07 in the afternoon. When smoke cleared, the police approached the vehicle. They saw that only Susie's damaged head and torso remained. She'd been sitting on top of the bomb that Fritz had installed in the vehicle. So the bottom half of her body was pretty much destroyed. Fritz had been thrown from the Blazer, and he survived for a minute or two. But it was the boys in the back that would really haunt responders.
Yeah, it was determined that the boys had been shot in the head, most likely by Susie, based on the trajectories of the angles. But they had also been given cyanide.
So on the scene, they can see that they've been shot. They don't know about the cyanide, of course.
Right.
Right. But it seems like they were dead before the explosion.
They were.
Now, Ian Perkins, he served 4 months in prison for his part in the Newsom murders. Dozens of guns and hundreds of rounds of ammunition were found in Susie's apartment, along with so many vitamins and pills that they said it took 3 dump trucks to haul them away. How do you fit all that in a 2-bedroom apartment?
I know. I mean, these were hoarders to an ultimate degree.
Yes.
They had stuff all over the place. But again, Fritz grew up this way.
Yeah, he seemed to go even further, though. He took it further.
Yes.
His father didn't murder anyone that we know of.
Not that we know of.
Right. So both of the boys, like you said, they had cyanide in their blood, very high levels. So it's determined that they were poisoned in the car during the chase and that Susie had shot them just before the explosion. Now, how did they figure out that Susie had done it?
Well, they had a couple things. One was that Fritz was driving the car, and it would be difficult for him, but they could determine that the one child had contact wounds, and the other one had been shot from a couple feet away. So they figured it most likely was Susie.
Because of the distance from the passenger seat
right,
to their
from
position?
The passenger seat to the rear seats.
Okay. Plus, they found out that she had gunshot residue on her hand. While at Fritz's mother's house, where Fritz and Dr. Klinner had lived, police found a half case of dynamite and evidence that Fritz was an admirer of Adolf Hitler and the Ku Klux Klan.
Yeah, well, Fritz was nuts. But
yeah.
he learned that from his father, who was equally nuts.
He did. And I think after his father died, he just really went over the edge.
Yeah.
Because he'd already disappointed his father not going to med school and that. So one more interesting thing is that in 1981, police at the State Bureau of Investigation were given anonymous information that Fritz was a dangerous psychopath who was practicing medicine without a license. But no investigation was done, and the information never reached the Attorney General's office. So this makes me think that this really went through the cracks, and those boys died when they didn't have to.
There's quite a possibility of that.
Yeah.
I mean, and the stuff I read was that the Kentucky officials, when they were investigating the murder of Tom's mother and sister, had evidence that Susie might be involved, and they found out that Fritz was with Susie.
Right, they found out that they were in that area, right?
And they wanted to have more information about things, but never were able to get that.
From the North Carolina?
From the North Carolina police, or SBI.
Well, and I would think even if they didn't have enough to arrest Fritz earlier, someone could have called social services about those boys living in a house with all that stuff.
I think so.
Yep. So also in 1994, a TV movie based on this case was produced by CBS. It was a two-part series, but it's also available in one lump on YouTube, and it's pretty good, pretty well done.
Yeah, it stays to the story pretty nicely.
Yeah, I mean, the movie's a little outdated, but I think it was done well. I think Kelly McGillis plays Susie.
She was pretty good.
She was, yeah. So what about this whole vitamin C, vitamin injection stuff that Dr. Klinner did? I mean, in the intro you heard there was a doctor supporting it and saying that he's just brilliant. Is there anything to it?
Well, I was going to interrupt during the intro, but then cooler minds prevailed.
Okay.
Because there isn't any evidence whatsoever that vitamin C does anything that this doctor was claiming.
Well, I mean, let's look at the things he was claiming.
Okay. So it doesn't cure cancer. It doesn't prevent heart disease. It doesn't cure flu. It doesn't
cure MS.
It doesn't cure the common cold.
Well, what about this story that they talked about? And I don't know if we included it in this podcast, but there was a story about some premature triplets or something that were born in the 1940s that Dr. Klinner saved their lives.
By giving them vitamin C.
That was part of it.
That's all bullshit. There is no evidence that vitamin C does anything other than to prevent scurvy.
Right, right.
Which we don't see too much of these days.
No.
But, you know, scurvy, kind of like this connective tissue disorder where you can have open sores, bleeding gums, and so on, and you administer vitamin C, and you cure the disease.
Oh, yeah, that's a fascinating story about back on the ships.
Right.
Yeah.
The sailors all needed vitamin C supplements.
Right.
So they wouldn't get scurvy. But other than preventing scurvy, there's no evidence whatsoever that vitamin C does anything.
What about these massive vitamin injections of B12 and D and anything to any of that?
No.
Okay.
Nothing.
All right. So he was pretty quacky, even though probably a smart man, but...
I think that he believed in what he was doing.
Yeah, but I think at one point he was warned by the medical board or something to stop doing that or he was going to lose his license.
Well, yeah, probably.
Yeah, he was pretty out there.
But I guess the only thing I'd say is what I've said before. There's no evidence that vitamin C does anything beneficial.
And you've checked recent research, so we know that you're right.
We know that.
Okay. All right, thanks. So let's just take a second to talk about Tie Grabber. That's our members-only podcast feed. And we're in the midst of covering honeymoon murders, or as we call them, honeymoon misadventures. In September, we covered the disappearance of George Smith on his honeymoon on a cruise ship. Our October case was Annie Dewani, who was killed by a carjacker in 2010 while on her honeymoon in South Africa. Now, with that one, there was some evidence that her new husband was the mastermind behind the killing. While a lot of family secrets were revealed, Shren Dewani, her husband, was acquitted of her murder. Now, Annie's family feels that justice wasn't served in this case. Now, our most popular recommendation for a honeymoon murder is the case of Tina Watson. Now, Tina was on her honeymoon in Australia when she died scuba diving. Her husband was suspected of murdering her, and he went to trial. He was almost tried in Australia and the U.S., but... that kind of came to an end. Anyway, not to give too much away, we're interviewing Michael McFadden, an Australian scuba diver who was slated to testify for Tina's husband Gabe in his murder trial in the U.S., but then it turned out they didn't need him. So we've built a good collection of these members-only podcasts, and if you join Tie Grabber today, you can download them all and have yourself a little True Crime Brewery binge. We're proud of them. They turned out nicely.
I like them.
We put a lot of effort in. Now, joining is very easy. Just go to tiegrabber.com. You can sign up. Or if you don't want to sign up that way, you can also support us on Patreon and listen to these members-only episodes there as a patron. Now, you can also support us in another way, which is completely free. The next time you shop on Amazon, just go into Amazon through our link on tiegrabber.com before you start shopping. So this is a really great way to support the podcast. If you have feedback for us, you can contact us at truecrimebrewery@tiegrabber.com. on Twitter at TigerEverPods, on our Instagram, or on Facebook. Now, we also have a Facebook discussion page where you can share suggestions or comments that we will be happy to share on one of our upcoming episodes. Now, we really do appreciate all of our listeners, and I want you to know that I do read all of your feedback, and I try to get to the topic that you've brought up on every show. Even if I don't get to your letter, I will get to someone's letter who brought it up before you. I try and go with the first person, first come, first serve. Thank you so much for all of you who support us and listen to us each week. And one more little request, if you have a few spare minutes, please give us a 5-star review on iTunes if you like us and tell your friends about our podcast. So that takes care of the self-promotion portion. And Dick has a little something to share.
I have one more monetary promotion.
Okay.
From Mathnesium. But remember, every child has their own unique learning style, especially when it comes to math. Mathnasium is the leading math-only learning center that is committed to the belief that a fundamental understanding of math can boost any child's success in school and in life. So start your child's new learning journey today. Learn more at mathnasium.com/offers/brewery.
Okay, thanks, Dick. Let's have a little music and get to feedback.
Let's hit the feedback.
We have great feedback today, some really interesting stuff.
Okay, you always keep it as a surprise for me.
Yes. Okay, welcome to feedback.
Let's get started. I think it's your turn to go first, Jill.
Okay. I have a suggestion from Snoopy. It's not spelled like the dog Snoopy. It's S-N-U-P-I-E, but I think that's how you pronounce it.
Well, I pronounce it Snoopy.
Okay. Hello, True Crime Brewery. I began listening to the podcast with Sugar and Spice episode. Now I play and replay all the episodes to and from work as well as at work. I've even started on the Watching ID podcast. Continue to give us quality and insightful discussions on interesting crime cases. Suggestion alert, the Leicester Street murders from Memphis, Tennessee. Dotson, 35, who had served almost 14 years in prison for a 1994 murder, was convicted of shooting to death his brother Cecil, 30, on March 2, 2008, on Leicester Street, and then eliminating witnesses, including Marissa Williams, 27, Shindra Robertson, 22, Hollis Seals, 33, and Cecil's children, Samario 4 and Cecil II, 2 years old.
Eliminating as in killing them?
Yes.
Holy shit.
So this incident was featured on the first 48, and Snoopy was great, gave us links to where we can find news clips, autopsy reports, and the first 48 video. So you can't get much more thorough than that. I'm going to look into this.
I think so. This is definitely going above and beyond eliminating witnesses.
I know, right?
Holy cow.
Sounds bad. But yeah, thank you, Snoopy.
Okay, I'm up. I got a note from Doreen concerning men who murder their wives or girlfriends.
This is a very insightful one.
We have that as a recurring topic, don't we?
We do. We like that as
a
topic.
And this is a great letter. So I appreciate how many of your episodes are about murders committed by family members and in relationships. To me, these are the cases which fascinate me with the intricacies of interpersonal relationships and joys and pains which most of us can relate to from our own life experiences. And we would only echo that, I think.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's what fascinates us.
That's true.
Doreen says, I recently read an article in a psychology journal about the profile of murderers who kill intimate partners and family members and how they have a significantly different psychological and forensic profile from murderers who kill people they don't know. I think so.
Yeah, it's definitely in the research.
The latest knowledge about murderers who commit spontaneous domestic homicide, emotionally driven crimes, is being researched to enable early intervention to prevent these homicides. And as you know, 1/3 of all women murdered in the United States are killed by their male partners.
And it's even higher for pregnant women. We've learned that.
We've learned that, but I'm amazed. 1/3?
Absolutely.
Wow.
I'm surprised it's not more, actually.
So one important thing to note, intimate partners and family members need to recognize that they're in risk of harm and remove themselves from the situation early on. Of course, this is a difficult thing. Well, time and again, we've seen that in the stuff we've discussed. But if we could learn to recognize early warning signs like possessiveness, jealousy, narcissism, women could leave men before they become abusive to the point of danger. In other words, after a few dates. Yeah, don't even marry the guy or live with the guy.
Well, I think that's when you could probably get away safely, right? Once you get really involved and they get, and they've honed in on you.
Yeah.
Well, it's really almost impossible to leave.
And as Doreen says, I mean, once you're in deep into the relationship, it gets really difficult to extricate yourself.
Absolutely. I mean, that's when people start saying, why didn't she leave? And we know absolutely why, because when you leave and you're deeply into a relationship with someone like that,
yeah,
you're at very high risk to be killed.
Yeah. So I like her thoughts. A few dates.
Yes.
Before you get too
involved. Because you know.
Involved.
I think for the most part you know. There might be cases where you don't, but I feel like within 2 or 3 dates, you know if you're with someone that you shouldn't be.
Yeah. I think that while you're dating is the perfect time to assess the psychological makeup of your prospective mate.
Absolutely.
And you can decide what you need to do.
Yeah.
So here's another reason to tell your daughters and sisters to take it slow when beginning a new romantic relationship.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Doreen. And Doreen says, thank you for all you do. Your podcast is more than entertaining. It is educational.
Oh, thanks, Doreen.
That's why we read this article. No.
No. It's a great
that.
Letter. But yeah, I mean, hallelujah on the taking it slow, right? Because I know a lot of people who jump right in with someone they don't really know. And I understand, you know, they think they're in love and everything, but whoa, slow it down.
Well,
slow it down, girlfriend.
I mean, that's the tough part, though. You're madly in love or madly in lust.
Yes.
And all you're seeing is the good aspects.
I know.
And
that's
you,
when cooler heads prevail.
Yeah. So take it slow.
Absolutely. I mean, if it's going to last, it'll last. Rushing into it isn't going to help things.
No. And it could prevent, if you don't rush into things, it could prevent some tragedy down the road.
Absolutely. I think so. So I have a letter from Lenny Ann on Sympathy for the Devil. That's the Belinda Temple case. When I started today's podcast, my stomach dropped. I'm very close to this case as my sister is married to one of David's brothers. One thing I respect about your podcast is the deep coverage of the victim. Thank you for taking the time to talk about what an amazing person Belinda was. I really enjoyed the times I had with her, often rollerblading and listening to 90s rap. I understand that there are details about this case that make David look guilty, and I respect your opinions. I must state that we as David's family and extended family stand behind his innocence 100%. I was happy to hear a bit about Riley Joe Sanders as a suspect, but wish you would have covered some of the other suspects in the case. I also really wish that you would have spent more time on diving into Kelly Siegler, her corrupt actions and motivations in this case and others. Lastly, some of the things you said about Katie and the Temple family could be said of any family from Katie. I grew up there, and I can attest that football players and Katie are truly like celebrities. So the way David was treated was not unique. I truly enjoy your podcast and hope you understand why I felt compelled to write this.
Okay, so where do I start?
I think thank you, Lenny Ann, for writing such a nice, respectful letter, not being argumentative.
Okay.
I think that this part about other suspects, I don't really know about other suspects.
I'm not sure. Other than her husband and the neighbor, I don't know that there are other suspects.
I do think that Kelly Siegler can be very gung-ho about prosecuting people. I mean, we watch her show Cold Justice, and sometimes I think, well, you don't really have a case. I feel like she does jump to people being guilty.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But at the same time, I think that she provided the defense with everything that she's legally required to.
As far as we know.
As far as we know.
As far as we know, yeah.
I mean, she might have stretched the limits sometimes.
But I can understand if the defendant is someone you care about,
you wouldn't
be happy with her.
No.
No.
Who would be?
And I respect that that's your family member and you're going to think they're innocent. So.
Right. And yeah. The final thing about the football mentality in small towns or bigger towns. Yeah, we've talked about that. My biggest beef is that they are celebrities, but they're not major celebrities. I mean, this is high school football, for crying out loud.
But in town they are, is what they're saying. In town they're like celebrities. Yeah.
And I just think that's wrong.
Well, I mean, if that's the way it is, that's really not right or wrong, I think. But I do feel like the parents needed to hone that in a bit and make him more accountable.
Well, I think somebody needs to tone it down a little bit.
I think it's important to keep these kids grounded.
Yeah, because otherwise they feel that they're entitled the whole time.
Yeah, and that's kind of the way I felt, although I don't know David, so I can't say absolutely. I'm just saying my opinions.
Yeah, yeah. Me too.
Right, it's just our opinions. So I have another one on the same case, and this is from Yvonne in the UK. I really enjoyed the Sympathy for the Devil podcast yesterday. I live in Scotland, so I had never heard of this case before. After listening to the podcast, I felt pretty certain that David Temple is guilty. But then I watched the two 48 Hours episodes afterwards, and I'm not sure what to think now.
Yeah, well, we went through the same process.
Right. There's no doubt David Temple treated his wife atrociously, and his actions on the day of the murder are a bit suspect. I'd be really interested to hear anybody else's take on this really heartbreaking case. And I have a couple more about this case also. This was a popular feedback case.
It seems to be a popular case for the feedback aspect.
Yeah.
What else you got, or do you want me to do something?
Do you have any comments on Yvonne's? Other than we went through the same thing when we watched the shows.
No, I think we did the same stuff. I mean, if you read the book...
Yeah, we read the book first.
And we did that first, and there's absolutely no question in our minds that he's guilty.
The book is pretty positive about that, yeah.
And then you watch the shows, and you say, well, wait a minute, maybe there's something else going on here.
Right, so then you dig a little deeper.
But I'm still thinking that there's nobody else that would have done it.
Well, that's the common sense idea about it is... It was probably him. Who else had any reason to kill her?
You go back to what's the most logical explanation.
Right.
And that's him.
Which doesn't make a conviction.
I know.
We have to be honest about that.
The fact that we think that the most likely scenario is that he killed his wife doesn't mean it is enough to get a conviction.
Right. So he might be free now. They might not take it back to court.
We haven't heard
if they're going to have him go through it again. And I would agree that the evidence... is not super compelling.
Well, no, it isn't. I mean, it's basically all circumstantial stuff that really points to him.
All right, so the next one is by another guy named David, talking about David, commenting on Sympathy for the Devil. David really thinks that David Temple's guilty, just to pre-warn anyone listening.
Okay.
If you're sympathetic for David Temple, this David is not. Driving your sick child around town to the park to purchase two drinks... Go to two stores with no car seat. Yes, he's guilty. It's so sad and tragic. She didn't deserve to die, nor her unborn baby. It disgusts me to no end that Heather was allowed to raise David and Belinda's son, Evan. I can't even imagine him having to identify being raised by the slut, these are David's words, that his dad was having an illicit affair with when he sadly killed Evan's mom. The dog, known for being ferocious, the neighbor being unable to enter the home because of the dog, the police being unable to enter the yard in the home because of the dog, the broken glass off to the side, all proves the door was open when the glass was shattered, it was a poorly staged robbery. David's motive clearly defined he was in love with Heather and told her Just days prior to the murder, he wanted to spend his life with her. The terrible treatment of his pregnant wife and unborn child, taking a sick child to at least three stops, four if you believe that he went to a park, using no car seat for the child, nothing missing from the Temple home. He's guilty and he belongs on death row in Texas. So he doesn't mince words.
David doesn't, and he's saying the same things that we were saying in terms of the evidence against David Temple.
Yes, but it is all circumstantial.
It is, but I think it's strongly circumstantial.
Yes, absolutely. And one more from Kara on Sympathy for the Devil. Super long post, sorry, in response to the thread started by an extended family member of David Temple. So all these letters were on our discussion group, and it started a thread. I'm also posting as a new thread in case anyone wants to discuss, share their thoughts on this episode. Of course, his family and extended family stand behind him. Tell me something we don't know, with the post you started saying nothing new and then leaving the conversation, which rubbed me the wrong way, clearly. I left the episode feeling that it's possible, but not probable, someone outside of David killed Belinda. I take issue primarily with three things. The dog would have attacked any unknown person in the yard. No one takes a sick kid out and about. Sick kids are not super pleasant shopping or playing companions. 3. 6 days before the murder, Heather essentially told David she wasn't happy with the way things were going, the relationship, and was going to end the relationship, and his alleged response to her was, "Okie dokie, I understand." Sure it was. He was cavorting with her within about 5 minutes of burying his wife. But he was cool with her calling things off? No. Not buying what she's selling. As an aside, what a vapid whore she is. Are you so desperate for attention? Married men are the only people capable of filling the void? No shame. I think David wanted out to be with his skank of a side piece. I think he committed a crime with just enough luck he's only tied to it circumstantially for now. As far as the notion David isn't as bad as he was portrayed, a pinky swear from extended family claiming he's just misunderstood doesn't cut it. He may not be found guilty of murder yet, but it doesn't take a rocket scientist to see he's guilty of being a total piece of shit. Another aside, had he treated some women, myself included, the way he treated his wife, there would be reason to have sympathy for him, I assure you. I had the same feeling after watching reading this case elsewhere. I'll try to do more homework on it when I can. At the end of the day, an innocent woman and child are dead. A son is without a mom, a family without their loved one. Speaking of family, I'd be interested to know how much time Belinda's family got to spend with Evan. I can guess. It's tragic. As a mom, it breaks my heart for multiple reasons. It's refreshing, though, to see how thoughtful David was in terms of moving on and how hard he works to keep Belinda's memory alive. A little sarcasm there. That's right, he wasn't and he doesn't. Great guy. Just remember, there aren't copious amounts of perfect crimes. Hopefully, whomever did this looks over their shoulder every day of their sad, pathetic life until the truth catches up with them. Thanks, Kara.
Good letter.
Yeah.
I mean, she's said the same things that other people have said.
Yeah, can I just say one thing about Heather?
Sure.
I think that we're all very quick to make Heather into the bad guy, as you say. And sure, her behavior wasn't perfect, but she wasn't the one that was married, and she's not the one who killed her. So it's more David's fault than hers.
Well, I could agree with that. My difficulty with her is that she knew he was a married man, and she still was having a relationship with him. And
she knew that his wife was pregnant.
Right, and that's not a nice thing to do.
No, it's not. So. But it doesn't make her a criminal.
No, it doesn't.
And as far as we know, she did a good job raising Evan. Now, if I was a member of Belinda's family, that would sicken me.
Right, it would.
Yeah.
And if you're a member of Belinda's family and you probably have had little to no contact with Evan.
Absolutely.
That would piss me off, too.
That's upsetting, yeah. I agree. It's a heartbreaking case. Okay, so you have a couple more?
I have a couple more, and then I got one more for you.
All right.
So this is in response to a killer in the family, which was the Becky Watts murder.
Yep, the most recent episode.
I think most recent.
Yeah.
The 16-year-old who was killed by her stepbrother and his girlfriend.
Right.
So I have a couple letters here. I have one from Valerie, who says, OMG, are you trying to kill me? I love the song Forever Young, but playing it after the story, instant tears. I Googled the story. She was beautiful and could have had a bright future. What a dirtbag that boy and his skanky girlfriend are. She says, I hope their kids are being well cared for. Probably better off. Incidentally, in one of your episodes, you mentioned Rob Leonard, who analyzed some emails in one of the cases. And Valerie says, I studied with Rob and some other awesome and notable people as a student in his Master of Arts Forensic Linguistics program at Hofstra. So here we got someone who's got firsthand knowledge. I always like that. I went back to school at age 44 thanks to that awesome program. I was part of the third cohort to be admitted. It's the first and still only, I think, program of its kind in the United States, and it's fascinating. I'd be thrilled to talk to you more about it. Google forensic linguistics for a better idea of the basics. And there's also some good YouTube videos. So, Valerie, I think we should be using you as a source sometimes.
I can't wait to look into that.
We're going to keep you in mind, girl.
Forensics linguistics, that sounds interesting.
Absolutely. So, and then I have another note from A Killer in the Family by Alana. What a sad case. I never heard of it before. I plan to read The Evil Within. I feel so badly for the father and stepmother. And kudos for your reasonable defense of your comments about Russell Williams' wife. That was the officer in a psychopath episode.
Yeah, it's been a big thing.
This is after we got taken to task.
Yeah.
So Alana says you're both good for retracting, rewording some of your comments if warranted when challenged. She agrees with your take on his wife. And then she goes on to say the Blagg case is a very good one. Detectives and volunteers spent weeks and found the wife in a landfill, but the daughter was too small to locate.
Yeah, that we've gotten another email about. That's a case we're going to do.
We are doing that one.
Yeah, thank you, Alana. Alana writes to us a lot, and she's always got some great stuff to say.
She has some good insights into things.
Yeah, she does. Okay, so our last letter is from MSVic66, and this is regarding the suggestion that we cover the Candy Montgomery case. Yes, do the Candy Montgomery case. She definitely did it. She admitted as much, but her attorney used the excuse that the woman attacked her first, and because of her being so repressed, she flipped out and killed the woman in the woman's own house with an axe. She even took a shower afterwards in the woman's shower. Yeah, she was repressed. That's why she approached her friend's husband for sex. Total miscarriage of justice. She should still be in prison. It's a fascinating case. There's a documentary on it from that old show from Court TV. You have to pay a small amount for that one, however, to see it on YouTube. Also, there's a movie called A Killing in a Small Town with Barbara Hershey playing Candy and Brian Dennehy as her attorney.
That might be fun
to watch,
huh?
That sounds great, yeah. The movie pretty much paints Candy as the poor repressed woman who flipped out, but I don't believe it. Also, ID had an episode on it from that show that only lasted a season called The Stepford Wives or something like that. It was very campy, so it did not last as it did not treat the cases with respect. At any rate, it would be a very good case for the show, in my opinion, if some kind of twisted coincidence the victim's name was Betty Gore. Since she was killed with an axe, that's kind of creepy, isn't it? And she gives us a link to the documentary.
All right.
So thank you, MSVic66.
Good points. We like that.
Yeah, I'm really excited about doing that one.
Yeah.
We probably had at least 10 people write in about that one.
Yeah, everybody likes that case.
Yep, so we'll do that. So that's it for feedback, and that wraps up our episode for today. We'll be getting out our members-only episode, hopefully this week, about Tina Watson. So if you aren't a member, go ahead and sign up. If you are a member, we'll have that out to you soon.
We will.
Okay, thanks everyone for listening.
See you next time.
We'll see you at the quiet end. Now, Susie Sharp is used to the best.
That's right.
So this, I'm shocked she's willing to do this.
She's a Sharp from North Carolina.
I know. I mean, I almost give her credit that she was willing to go without like that. Because I wouldn't have thought she would have it in her.
No, that's for sure. But again, I just keep coming back to, man, you should have planned better.
Of course. It was very sudden and, yeah. So she had to share this apartment with a landlady, too. So she and the boys have two small bedrooms, and they share a bath and the kitchen. Classes began just a few days after they arrived, and she was struggling to learn, you know, how to manage her life there, to learn bus schedules, and to even know the geography of the neighborhood.
Yeah.
Stressful.
Yeah. So, yeah. I mean, pretty quickly she figured out that she'd made a big mistake.
I think she did, yeah.
And she felt kind of guilty for putting the boys in this position. They stayed there for 6 months before they came back home. Boys were dirty and malnourished, and Susie was quite disillusioned.
Yeah, Susie's mother, Florence, was really shocked to see Susie's condition when they returned. And Susie decided she was going to see the doctor in the family, Dr. Fred Klinner. Now, his office was in a very unlikely spot. The narrow front entrance was situated between a beauty shop and a local TV station. There was a hand-painted sign reading Fred R. Klinner, Diseases of the Chest, Limited General Practice. So doorways led to separate waiting rooms for blacks and whites, which is something that he maintained well into the 1980s.
When integration had been long ago introduced.
He was very racist.
Oh, no kidding.
Now, two walls were covered with official-looking certificates and diplomas. He was a smart and educated man in that respect. But kind of a nutso, right? Kind of a...
Kind of.
Is there a better way to say that?
But she went to see him because he was married to one of her aunts.
Mm-hmm.
So this is their, like, family doctor.
Right. It's her uncle.
Yeah.
So the furnishings were very masculine. There were a lot of antiques around. But it was super cluttered. There were old medical instruments, and there's this big vintage Bible. And very strangely, he had hung two hornet's nests as decoration from old pipes on the ceiling.
Yeah, he had a real eclectic mix of decor.
He sure did. That's a nice way to put it.
And there was just an absolutely astounding amount of clutter in his office and in his home, and as it turns out, in Fritz's home.
Yes.
But there was a lot of clutter. Files of medicine there looked older than the doctor. And he had a huge red, white, and blue George Wallace for President poster, and gun magazines scattered all over on the tables.
Yeah, well, depending on who you asked, Dr. Klinner was either one of the most cutting-edge physicians or a huge quack. So he graduated from his father's practice. After a bitter divorce, Susie became volatile and paranoid. She was lonely, and her cousin Fritz was there for her. She became involved with Fritz, a college failure who was practicing medicine illegally at that point.
Yeah, he never did go to medical school.
No. Now, he also had a frightening fascination with guns, and he claimed to work for the CIA. So a child custody dispute over Susie's children became bitter as Susie and Fritz isolated themselves from the world outside, and they did everything they could to keep her two young boys from their father. Then relatives began turning up dead, five of them in all. Even as Fritz and Susie were suspected, her children were left in the control of these two dangerous people. Now follow us through this tale of family destruction, beyond what anyone could have predicted. This episode of True Crime Brewery is a stranger-than-fiction family tragedy, love and madness, murders in a southern family. And what are we drinking while we talk about this?
We are drinking a fine Kentucky beer called Beau and Luke, Dukes of Hazzard.
Nice.
It's brewed by Against the Grain Brewery and Smokehouse in Louisville. Now, Beau and Luke is a Russian Imperial Stout. I'm going to sound like a broken record because I think I've been doing a lot of these lately. But just to remind people, the Russian Imperial Stout is the king, or if you want, queen of stouts. It was originally brewed for the Tsar of Russia to impress him. They tend to be highly alcoholic. They have a roasted, burnt, or chocolate malt aroma. Chocolate or coffee taste, dark fruit, and hops are generally pretty quiet. Now, this particular one, Old Beau and Luke, is a chestnut brown color with a frothy tan head that sticks around for a while. It has an aroma of smoked wood, whiskey, and cocoa. and the taste follows the nose quite well. Smoked wood, chocolate, whiskey, a little bit of vanilla. This is a full-bodied beer. The whiskey is kind of prominent, so if you don't particularly care for alcohol, maybe don't go with this one.
Okay, I think most beer drinkers have some enjoyment of alcohol.
Yeah.
To some extent.
You don't want it taking over the whole taste.
Does this do that?
No, I don't think it does, but it's definitely noticeable.
Okay.
It's a good beer.
All right, well, let's open it up. I'm anxious to taste that.
Okay.
Okay, let's take that beer down to the quiet end.
You got it. You know, people are back to normal down there. I was enjoying the costumes from last week.
Yes.
But now it's back to the normalcy.
Okay. Yeah, a little bit drab, honestly, but...
Yeah, but that's us.
That's us. Okay. All right.
Okay, let's start. So,
listeners, and there's a $250 prize.
That's true.
Yep. So,
and we've seen some good entries already.
Yeah.
I'm very impressed. There's some I really like.
Yeah.
But I'm not telling you which ones.
No, because we still have a long way to go, because the contest goes on until February 1st.
Right. So get those entries in.
Yeah. You can send your entry to us on Instagram, Twitter, or Facebook, or in an email to truecrimebrewery@tiegrabber.com. So what we need from you is a design that shows the heart of what True Crime Brewery is in a catchy design that looks good on a t-shirt. Doesn't sound like too much to ask, but there's a lot to it.
Well, there is. I mean, it sounds simple.
It does.
But what we're looking for doesn't necessarily have to be simple.
Well, the thing is, the really genius things in life look simple and easy, but they're not, right? A lot of thought goes into it.
Exactly.
Right. So we have big plans for these t-shirts made with this design for a crime con in the spring. And True Crime Brewery isn't for everyone. It's kind of a niche. So we really need someone who understands us to design our t-shirts. And who better than a listener?
See?
Right? So I think that it will be really good. Now we can start our story. So we all have someone in our family who's a little bit unstable.
We certainly do. I can name a few.
Can you? In your own family?
Both our families.
Right. So you could have an eccentric aunt or a brother who's preparing for the zombie apocalypse, maybe. But what happens when a family member sinks deeply into true madness, becoming a danger to himself and to others? This is when interventions are needed or lives can just fall apart. Now, Susie Sharp was born to a prominent Southern family, and she was meant for greatness. Her cousin, Fritz Klinner, was the son of a physician, and he was expected to take over his father's practice. After a bitter divorce, Susie became volatile and paranoid. She was lonely, and her cousin Fritz was there for her. She became involved with Fritz, a college failure who was practicing medicine illegally at that point.
Yeah, he never did go to medical school.
No. Now, he also had a frightening fascination with guns, and he claimed to work for the CIA. So a child custody dispute over Susie's children became bitter as Susie and Fritz isolated themselves from the world outside, and they did everything they could to keep her two young boys from their father. Then relatives began turning up dead, five of them in all. Even as Fritz and Susie were suspected, her children were left in the control of these two dangerous people. Now follow us through this tale of family destruction, beyond what anyone could have predicted. This episode of True Crime Brewery is a stranger-than-fiction family tragedy, love and madness, murders in a Southern family. And what are we drinking while we talk about this?
We are drinking a fine Kentucky beer. It's called Beau and Luke, Dukes of Hazzard.
Nice.
It's brewed by Against the Grain Brewery and Smokehouse in Louisville. Now, Beau and Luke, so she kept the bedroom shut. So John had been fine when Susie picked him up at the babysitter's. So the implication is that this was some injury caused by Susie.
Had to be, right?
Right.
Yeah.
And the babysitter noticed other signs of abuse. Jim often had red eyes, bloody nose, once had a large lump on his head, which was described the size of a softball.
Right.
Susie, now that's pretty huge. I don't know about that, but...
Yeah. Well, Susie said she'd take him to the doctor, but she didn't. She pretended to take him to the doctor. The babysitter found that out. Now, Tom saw the lump that evening and was concerned, and he did take Jim to the hospital. And Jim had a concussion and a lot of facial bruising.
Yeah, now how did that happen?
I don't know. I mean, when you get hit in the head, bruising can spread to your face, right?
Sure. After time.
Right. But not the same day?
Probably not the same day.
Well, the doctors were suspicious. They wanted to keep him overnight, and Susie argued with them. The injuries were suspicious, but Tom, he couldn't believe that Susie would have hurt the child. He'd never seen her abuse the children in front of him. Of course, he's never really home.
But he's not home. He's trying to get his practice established.
Yeah, and I think when he wasn't working, he was trying to go play sports and just be away from the house as much as possible.
Right. And you're not going to question your wife, because you can't possibly think that your wife would harm your own child.
Right.
Right?
Well, because she seemed protective of them and possessive of them in another way, so it was kind of a strange situation.
It was.
Jim was admitted to the hospital that time, and he stayed for 2 days, but for some reason, no charges were filed.
Yeah, I mean, this is an interesting thing. I mean, if you think that the kid might have been abused, you're going to call the Department of Social Services, right?
Right.
So I don't know if they never did that. Or if they did and they decided that there was no evidence for abuse?
Yeah, it seems like at some point social services did visit the home, but nothing became of it.
Right.
Right. But isn't there a way to tell from a broken arm there's certain types of breaks that are more likely from abuse?
Oh, certainly.
Want to talk just a little bit about that?
Okay. I mean, the breaks that are more consistent with injury are what are called spiral fractures, like twisting. So you got your arm caught in something. Other kinds of breaks might be more suspicious for abuse. And you're looking also at other sites of injury. So if you have an injury that doesn't sound like it could be accidental, you might do a total body x-ray and you find old fractures that are healing.
Oh, yeah.
Which would certainly be a sign of abuse.
Well, plus the facial bruising he had.
Yeah, I mean, he had a knock on the head.
Yeah.
Facial
So Tom was kind of caught between these two strong-willed women trying to make peace. Not easy to do.
No, he found himself constantly trying to do something to make peace between the two of them.
Yeah, and he was kind of laid back, so this was probably, you know, didn't make any sense to him. And he was used to his mother being that way anyway, right?
But, and I don't think he was going to be that effective as a peacemaker.
No, so he kind of married someone who was like his mother in that controlling, kind of domineering way.
Yes, he did.
Now, when their second child, James, was born, it was 1975, and Susie behaved the same way with this child. She felt like her family was above Tom's family, the Lynch family.
Well, you know, Susie's family is Southern gentility.
Right.
And his family is nouveau riche.
Yeah, and not really that riche, because Dolores was very frugal. She'd been poor when she was younger.
Yeah.
And she didn't have, like, great taste or anything. She kind of pocketed her money away. Now, Tom decided to begin his dental practice out west in Albuquerque, New Mexico. And there was a lot of growth out there at the time. A dentist there had invited Tom to join him. Now, Susie, of course, didn't want to go. But this is early in the marriage, and she actually gave in to Tom for once. But she immediately hated it there. She said that it lacked culture and dignity. Now, one of the things might have been that people didn't recognize her family name, and she was treated just like everybody else, which she didn't like.
Oh, that's so horrible.
She wanted to be special.
Yeah, now on the other hand, Tom loved Albuquerque.
Yeah, it's more his scene. He's laid back.
Yeah, it's kind of a Wild West town.
Yeah.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
And he got along well with his colleagues, the Giomini brothers. There were two of them, Armand and Robert. They accepted Tom as a partner in their dental practice. So 6 months after arriving in Albuquerque, Tom and Susie bought a house in the valley near the city's historic district. What do they call it? Old Town?
Old Town. Mm-hmm.
So it's a nice place.
It's very cool out there. I like it. But yes. Within a year, Susie was confiding in a friend that she was totally unhappy.
Yeah, she wanted Tom to go back to North Carolina to practice dentistry. She was complaining that she had no social identity in New Mexico and regularly dropped into conversations that her aunt was the Chief Justice of the State Supreme Court and that her uncle Fred Klenner was a world-famous doctor. So she's already trying to play up the
family.
But
she really tries to play herself up on the accomplishments of others in her family, not so much on herself, like you said.
Right, exactly.
Yeah. So Tom and Susie really don't have very much in common once you get down to it. Tom's outdoorsy, loves sports. Susie actually said that athletes were nothing but stupid, sweaty turkeys. Now, by their third year in Albuquerque, none of Tom's friends would visit at the house. Susie was a snob.
I believe invented intravenous vitamin C. Klenner was a giant of a man intellectually and professionally. But he was a genius. He was just an incredibly brilliant doctor. And he tells a story of the flu epidemic of 1918. And he lived in a small town in Pennsylvania. And in that epidemic, everybody was getting sick and lots of people were dying. It was a very vicious flu. Klenner's family used an herbal tea called Onicet tea. And everybody in his family would drink a cup or more a day. And nobody in his family got sick. Everybody else in town got sick, virtually without exception. And quite a few people died. He remembered this when he went to medical school years later. He found that Bonacet tea, the way they were preparing it, had 5,000 milligrams of vitamin C in it. Now remember, vitamin C recommended daily allowance by the FDA is 50 or 55 milligrams. And he started using vitamin C therapeutically. And he was really genius about it. He used the vitamin C on all sorts of things. And he saved a lot of babies, and he saved a lot of adults with it. And he taught people how to do this. And he taught us at ACAM, American College for Advancement in Medicine, where I was the fourth president. This is the group that has fought for and preserved the use of chelation therapy with EDTA and the use of intravenous vitamin C. And the vitamin C intravenously has been some of the most powerful stuff that I've ever seen.
Welcome to True Crime Brewery. I'm Jill.
And I'm Dick.
Now, before we begin, a reminder about our Design a True Crime Brewery t-shirt contest. We're looking for a cool new t-shirt design from one of our listeners, and there's a $250 prize.
That's true.
Yep.
So. And we've seen some good entries already.
Yeah.
I'm very impressed. There's some I really like.
Yeah.
I'm not telling you which ones.
No, because we still have a long way to go, because the contest goes on until February 1st.
Right, so get those entries in.
Yeah, you can send your entry to us on Instagram, Twitter, or Facebook, or in an email to truecrimebrewery@tiegrabber.com. So what we need from you is a design that shows the heart of what True Crime Brewery is in a catchy design that looks good on a t-shirt. Doesn't sound like too much to ask, but there's a lot to it.
Well, there is. I mean, it sounds simple.
It does.
But what we're looking for doesn't necessarily have to be simple.
Well, the thing is, the really genius things in life look simple and easy, but they're not, right? A lot of thought goes into it.
Exactly.
Right. So we have big plans for these t-shirts made with this design for a crime con in the spring. And True Crime Brewery isn't for everyone. It's kind of a niche, so we really need someone who understands us to design our t-shirts. And who better than a listener?
See?
Right? So I think that it will be really good. Promises. So as time passed, the mystery of who had killed Dolores and Janie went unsolved. During a follow-up visit to the house, several palm leaves were found arranged in crosses on the floor. And this is a mystery that's never been explained.
Right, but what I can explain is math. How's your child doing in math? Whether they need to get caught up or want to get ahead, Mathnasium is there to help. We are a big math family. Three of our children work in math-related fields, and we have a good understanding of the importance of math, not only in one's occupation, but also in day-to-day life. Mathnasium is a leading math-only learning center, where caring, qualified instructors help kids master the math skills they need to build confidence at school, improve test scores, open options for their future, and change their lives forever. Make tears and homework battles a thing of the past. I vote for that.
I do. I remember those days.
Yes. Because at Mathnasium, they don't just help kids understand math. They help kids enjoy math. Now, I can't tell you how many kids I see in my day-to-day practice that say they don't like math. So any program that turns kid into math enthusiasts is a great idea. Your child's learning journey can start today. Why delay such an important decision? So visit mathnasium.com/offers/brewery to learn more about their program and to download the ebook every parent needs, Helping Children Excel at Math. That's mathnasium.com/offers/brewery.
Okay. Now, John and Jim were visiting Tom in Albuquerque when Tom was notified that his mother and sister had been murdered. He asked Susie if the boys could stay on with him a few days as he grieved this loss, but She said, absolutely not.
Yeah. Nice empathy there, huh?
Right. Now, Susie's mother, Florence, called Tom with condolences, and he was very appreciative of her kindness. He took this opportunity to share with her his frustrations about not being able to see the boys as much as he should. He was concerned for their well-being, and he missed them. Now, Florence agreed with Tom that it is important for boys to maintain a strong relationship with their father, as well as their mother. Now, she and Susie's father, Bob, were worried about the boys, too, and they started to keep in contact with Tom.
Yeah, now, meanwhile, Tom doesn't realize that Susie and Fritz are referring to each other as husband and wife.
Not at all.
And the boys were calling Fritz Papa. Boy, that pissed me off.
Well, more than piss you off, it's worrisome. These are crazy people. I mean,
they're disturbed people. Descending into madness.
Yes.
So Fritz had moved many of his things into Susie's two-bedroom apartment. Susie's almost done with her master's degree in business administration, and Fritz is continuing.
I have a suggestion from Snoopy. It's not spelled like the dog Snoopy. It's S-N-U-P-I-E, but I think that's how you pronounce it.
Well, I pronounce it Snoopy.
Okay. Hello, True Crime Brewery. I began listening to the podcast with Sugar and Spice episode. Now I play and replay all the episodes to and from work as well as at work. I've even started on the Watching ID podcast. Continue to give us quality and insightful discussions on interesting crime cases. Suggestion alert. The Leicester Street Murders from Memphis, Tennessee. Dotson, 35, who had served almost 14 years in prison for a 1994 murder, was convicted of shooting to death his brother Cecil, 30, on March 2, 2008, on Leicester Street, and then eliminating witnesses, including Marissa Williams, 27, Shindra Robertson, 22, Hollis Seals, 33, and Cecil's children, Samario, 4, and Cecil II, 2 years old.
Eliminating as in killing them?
Yes.
Holy shit.
So this incident was featured on the First 48, and Snoopy was great, gave us links to where we can find news clips, autopsy reports, and the First 48 video. So you can't get much more thorough than that. I'm going to look into this.
I think so. This is definitely going above and beyond eliminating witnesses.
I know, right?
Holy cow.
Sounds bad. But yeah, thank you, Snoopy.
Okay, I'm up. I got a note from Doreen concerning men who murder their wives or girlfriends.
This is a very insightful one.
We have that as a recurring topic, don't we?
We do. We like that as a topic.
And this is a great letter. So I appreciate how many of your episodes are about murders committed by family members and in relationships. To me, these are the cases which fascinate me with the intricacies of interpersonal relationships and joys and pains which most of us can relate to from our own life experiences. And we would only echo that, I think.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's what fascinates us.
That's true.
Doreen says, I recently read an article in a psychology journal about the profile of murderers who kill intimate partners and family members and how they have a significantly different psychological and forensic profile from murderers who kill people they don't know. I think so.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's definitely in the research.
The latest knowledge about murderers who commit spontaneous domestic homicide, emotionally driven crimes, is being researched to enable early intervention to prevent these homicides. And as you know, 1/3 of all women murdered in the United States are killed by their male partners.
And it's even higher for pregnant women. We've learned that.
We've learned that, but I'm amazed. 1/3?
Absolutely.
Wow.
I'm surprised it's not more.
The difficulty with her is that she knew he was a married man, and she still was having a relationship with him. And
she knew that his wife was pregnant.
Right, and that's not a nice thing to do.
No, it's not.
So.
But it doesn't make her a criminal.
No, it doesn't.
And as far as we know, she did a good job raising Evan. Now, if I was a member of Belinda's family, that would sicken me.
Right, it would.
Yeah.
And if you're a member of Belinda's family, and you probably have had little to no contact with Evan.
Absolutely.
That would piss me off, too.
That's upsetting, yeah. I agree. It's a heartbreaking case. Okay, so you have a couple more?
I have a couple more, and then I got one more for you.
All right.
So this is a response to a killer in the family, which was the Becky Watts murder.
Yep, the most recent episode.
I think most recent.
Yeah.
The 16-year-old who was killed by her stepbrother and his girlfriend.
Right.
So I have a couple letters here. I have one from Valerie, who says, OMG, are you trying to kill me? I love the song Forever Young, but playing it after the story, instant tears. I Googled the story. She was beautiful and could have had a bright future. What a dirtbag that boy and his skanky girlfriend are. She says, I hope their kids are being well cared for. Probably better off. Incidentally, in one of your episodes, you mentioned Rob Leonard, who analyzed some emails in one of the cases. And Valerie says, I studied with Rob and some other awesome and notable people as a student in his Master of Arts Forensic Linguistics program at Hofstra. So here we got someone who's got firsthand knowledge. I always like that. I went back to school at age 44 thanks to that awesome program. I was part of the third cohort to be admitted. It's the first and still only, I think, program of its kind in the United States, and it's fascinating. I'd be thrilled to talk to you more about it. Google forensic linguistics for a better idea of the basics. And there's also some good YouTube videos. So, Valerie, I think we should be using you as a source sometimes.
Well, yeah, I can't wait to look into that.
We're going to keep you in mind, girl.
Forensics linguistics, that sounds interesting.
Absolutely. So, and then I have another note from A Killer in the Family by Alana. What a sad case. I never heard of it before. I plan to read The Evil Within. I feel so badly for the father and stepmother. And kudos for your reasonable defense of your comments about Russell Williams' wife. That was the officer in a psychopath episode.
Yeah, it's been a big thing.
This is after we thought of the taking wife. The task.
Yeah.
So Alana says you're both good for retracting rewordings, and her bosses liked her. And the extra money that came in certainly was useful to the family. But it didn't make the marriage any better. Tension was a constant in the house. Now that Christmas in 78, Susie brought the boys home to see her family, leaving Tom behind.
Well, that's not a good sign.
That isn't a good sign. And what did we read? I mean, I guess it was tough for him to get off work or something, but or she just announced that she's going home for Christmas
and taking
the kids.
Yeah, she didn't really want him to go.
Yeah.
Yeah, they were kind of living different lives already, separate lives. Because after she returned home, she was talking about a possible separation.
She was.
She got back from that trip, and she really wasn't invested in the marriage, as they say.
Right.
Now, the babysitter who watched John and Jim while Susie worked was worried about Susie's parenting. She was very controlling, inflexible, which, you know, you can't be with kids. You have to be flexible. And she also favored Jim because she felt like Jim was more like her. John was kind of an unhappy, withdrawn child. As punishment, he'd be forced to stay in his room all day sometimes. And both of the boys began to have some behavior problems, which Susie would just get more and more frustrated.
She did.
So she's kind of butting heads with her own children, too.
Well, I mean, sticking a kid in a room all day for misbehavior isn't the way to address behavior issues.
No, you're just taking away everything.
That's an easy thing to talk about.
It's not good.
And Susie's not a happy woman. She once beat the family dog with a plastic baseball bat right in front of the kids.
Can't imagine that.
And she had no problem spanking the kids when they misbehaved.
Or just outright hitting them.
Or just hitting them.
Yeah.
So one day Tom came home from work and he found John holding his arm in an awkward fashion. He removed John's shirt and saw that the arm looked broken. Now, John said he fell off the bed at the babysitter's. But if Tom had asked the babysitter, he would have learned from her that John had never been on any of the beds at her house. Her husband worked nights and slept all day, so she kept the bedroom shut. So John had been fine when Susie picked him up at the babysitter's. So the implication is that this was some injury caused by Susie.
Had to be, right?
Right.
Yeah.
And the babysitter noticed other signs of abuse. Jim often had red eyes, bloody nose, once had a large lump on his head, which was described the size of a softball.
Right.
Susie, now that's pretty huge. I don't know about that, but...
Yeah? Well, Susie said she'd take him to the doctor, but she didn't. She pretended to take him to the doctor. The babysitter found that out. Now, Tom saw the lump that evening and was concerned, and he did take Jim to the hospital. And Jim had a concussion and a house. And then no one discovered them for over a day.
Right. So this Dolores is lying outside in all the heat.
Oh, terrible.
Ugh.
This was shocking to the community, and it kind of looked like a professional hit because they were just shot and killed. There didn't seem to be a robbery. Now, Dolores is sprawled on her left side by the garage, and the top of her head and the left side of her face were pretty much gone. So you can imagine that this was disgusting. It was the most grotesque sight Police Chief Steve Nobles had ever seen. You can imagine it was very hot outside, and there's a horrible smell of death.
I can only imagine.
So inside the house is air conditioning, thank goodness, and there were two drops of blood near the kitchen counter. The burglar alarm was shut off. In an upstairs bedroom, a jewelry box was turned upside down, and the contents of Janie's purse were spilled out on the bed. Janie lay face down on a small rug in the sunroom. Now this room adjoined Dolores' bedroom, and the black and white top she wore had been torn by a bullet that struck her in the back by her right shoulder blade. Her hair was up in curlers, and one of the curlers was actually driven into her skull by a bullet. And no weapon was found on the premises. So as time passed, the mystery of who had killed Dolores and Janie went unsolved. During a follow-up visit to the house, several palm leaves were found arranged in crosses on the floor. And this is a mystery that's never been explained.
Right, but what I can explain is math. How's your child doing in math? Whether they need to get caught up or want to get ahead, Mathnasium is there to help. We are a big math family. Three of our children work in math-related fields, and we have a good understanding of the importance of math, not only in one's occupation, but also in day-to-day life. Mathnasium is a leading math-only learning center, where caring, qualified instructors help kids master the math skills they need to build confidence at school, improve test scores, open options for their future, and change their lives forever. Make tiers and homework battles a thing of the past. I vote for that.
I do. I remember those days.
Yes. Because at Mathnasium, they don't just help kids understand math. They help kids enjoy math. Now, I can't tell you how many kids I see in my day-to-day practice that say they don't like math. So any program that turns kids into math enthusiasts is a great idea. Your child's learning journey can start today. Why delay such an important decision? So visit mathnasium.com/offers/brewery to learn more about their program and to download the ebook Every Parent Needs, Helping Children Excel at Math. That's mathnasium.com/offers/brewery.
Okay. Now, John and Jim were visiting Tower, really.
Yes. So she was one of the most respected women in all of America. Now, growing up, Susie was considered to be a spoiled brat by most of the people who met her. Everything had to be her way. Now, as a child, she had such terrible temper tantrums that her mother used to put her in a cold shower to calm her down.
Well, I don't know how appropriate that is.
That's kind of cruel punishment, isn't it?
It seems a little dysfunctional, to be honest with you.
I think so, too.
Yeah.
So Susie went to college at Wake Forest, where she met Tom. Now, Tom came from a prosperous family in Kentucky.
Right, but they were kind of new money, where Susie was old money.
Susie was old money. Tom was new money in the sense that his father had a great job with General Electric.
Yeah.
And had risen through the ranks.
So it was only a couple generations with that family.
Right.
Yeah.
Now, Tom was a pre-med student with a basketball scholarship. I guess he was quite the ball player.
You know, good enough for that, but not anything like he's going to be professional or anything.
No.
No.
And he didn't have any illusions about being a pro basketball player.
I don't think so. I think it was a way to get to college. He wanted to be a doctor, right?
He did. Now, Tom was 2 years younger than Susie, and he was pretty laid back and a good athlete. So that's kind of an opposite from Susie. She certainly wasn't laid back.
No.
And he was handsome, but more importantly to Susie, he is going to be a doctor.
Sure.
Now, I'm thinking there's already some difficulty here, because Susie's an intelligent woman. Why is she just intent on marrying somebody who's going to be a doctor for the status? I mean, I would think she'd be looking to establish her own self.
Well, she did that as well, though. I think she just wanted to be paired up with someone successful.
She certainly did. So Tom, he's pretty flattered by all her attention. I mean, he's a couple of years younger than her, so he's got this hot-looking upperclassman going out with him.
Well, she was beautiful.
She was. And she was also inexperienced at romance. And Tom was her first real boyfriend. And while he seemed nice, his ambitions didn't seem nearly as high as Susie's. And a lot of people wondered if they were a good match.
Yeah, especially those who knew Susie really well. From her side, right?
Right.
Now, when Tom introduced Susie to his mother, Dolores, Dolores didn't care for her. She told her friends that Susie was snooty and pretentious. And after Tom proposed, Dolores tried to talk him out of marrying her. She didn't want Susie in their family, and the dislike was mutual. So the disdain between these two women was obvious from the get-go.
It certainly was. I mean, on the one hand, you figure the mother of the groom, no woman is going to be good enough for her precious son, right?
Some women are that way, yeah.
But still, this seems to be above and beyond that simple stuff.
I think so.
She really loathed Susie.
Susie did continue to attend classes and do well, getting her master's degree in business administration.
She was doing quite well in school from what we read.
She's a smart woman, yeah.
She's a very intelligent woman.
But he's still presenting himself as a doctor and offering medical advice to strangers. Now, Fritz was a regular customer at the local Kroger store, which was open 24 hours, and he usually shopped there after midnight. He was wearing camouflage fatigues or a doctor's coat with a stethoscope in the pocket. Now, he often spent time on the payphone out front. He bought rubbing alcohol, boxes of gauze and medical tape, and massive amounts of vitamins. Now, one night, Fritz became agitated when the total of the customer in front of him came to $6.66.
Oh, the mark of the beast.
That made him really upset, right?
Well, yeah, Armageddon is here.
Right. So people at Kroger are starting to wonder, is this guy really a doctor? And why is he buying all these vitamins and medical supplies here at the grocery store? And now he's freaking out over the 666.
That is true.
So he said that those numbers represented the mark of the beast, and he started talking then about the Battle of Armageddon. He actually said, "Before I'll take the mark of the beast, I'll take my wife and two children, and we'll go so far back in the mountains that not even the devil can find us."
This is nuts.
Now, in the late fall, Fritz began to go to the Army surplus store about once a week or even more, and he told the owner that he'd taken over his father's medical practice. Now, he bought knives, canteens, sleeping bags, food rations, and camouflage material. He never looked at the prices, so price was no object, I guess. And he bought books, mostly military manuals, on explosives, survivalism, and killing techniques. And he always paid cash.
He did.
Now, where was he getting the money?
Well, he got about $25,000 insurance money when his father died. But by the spring of 1985, he only had about $1,000 left. So he's been spending money.
Yeah.
He never missed a gun show. And he also bought weapons by mail order. And on the black market, he bought stolen military grenades, mines, and other explosives. So Fritz is convinced that Armageddon would be set off by a nuclear explosion that would result in panic and civil disorder. And he wanted to be prepared.
So this is something he probably picked up from his father, because he seemed to have similar beliefs.
Yeah, they're both crazy about that.
And what about his mother, the doctor's widow?
She was a pretty passive woman. I don't think she had much to do with it.
Yeah, she kind of went along with whatever the doctor said, right?
Yeah, she called him the doctor.
Yeah, kind of like around our house.
Yeah.
That's how things go.
Well, that's because I insist on it.
Well, of course. Now, in March, Tom and Kathy took the boys to Disneyland. And
note from Doreen concerning men who murder their wives or girlfriends.
This is a very insightful one.
We seem to have that as a recurring topic, don't we?
We do. We like that as a topic.
And this is a great letter. So, I appreciate how many of your episodes are about murders committed by family members and in relationships. To me, these are the cases which fascinate me with the intricacies of interpersonal relationships and joys and pains which most of us can relate to from our own life experiences. And we would only echo that, I think.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's what fascinates us.
That's true.
Doreen says, "I recently read an article in a psychology journal about the profile of murderers who kill intimate partners and family members and how they have a significantly different psychological and forensic profile from murderers who kill people they don't know. I think so.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's definitely in the research.
The latest knowledge about murderers who commit spontaneous domestic homicide, emotionally driven crimes, is being researched to enable early intervention to prevent these homicides. And as you know, 1/3 of all women murdered in the United States are killed by their male partners.
And it's even higher for pregnant women. We've learned that.
We've learned that, but I'm amazed. 1/3?
Absolutely.
Wow.
I'm surprised it's not more, actually.
So one important thing to note, intimate partners and family members need to recognize that they're in risk of harm and remove themselves from the situation early on. Of course, this is a difficult thing. Well, time and again, we've seen that in the stuff we've discussed. But if we could learn to recognize early warning signs like possessiveness, jealousy, narcissism, women could leave men before they become abusive to the point of danger. In other words, after a few dates. Yeah, don't even marry the guy or live with the guy.
Well, I think that's when you could probably get away safely, right? Once you get really involved and they've honed in on you.
Yeah.
Well, it's really almost impossible to leave.
And as Doreen says, I mean, once you're in deep into the relationship, it gets really difficult to extricate yourself.
Absolutely. I mean, that's when people start saying, why didn't she leave? And we know absolutely why, because when you leave and you're deeply into a relationship with someone like that,
yeah,
you're at very high risk to be killed.
Yeah. So I like her thoughts. A few dates.
Yes.
Before you get too
involved. Because you know.
Involved.
I think for the most part, you know. There might be cases where you don't, but I feel like within 2 or 3 dates, you know if you're with someone that you shouldn't be.
Yeah. I think that while you're dating is the perfect time to assess the psychological makeup of your prospective mate.
Absolutely.
And you can decide what you need to do.
Yeah.
So here's another reason to tell your daughters and sisters to take it slow when beginning a new romantic relationship.
Heard of this case before. After listening to the podcast, I felt pretty certain that David Temple is guilty. But then I watched the 2 48 Hours episodes afterwards, and I'm not sure what to think now.
Yeah, well, we went through the same process.
Right. There's no doubt David Temple treated his wife atrociously, and his actions on the day of the murder are a bit suspect. I'd be really interested to hear anybody else's take on this really heartbreaking case. And I have a couple more about this case also. This was a popular feedback case.
It seems to be a popular case for the feedback aspect.
Yeah.
What else you got? Or do you want me to do something?
Do you have any comments on Yvonne's? Other than we went through the same thing when we watched the shows.
I think we did the same stuff. I mean, if you read the book.
Yeah, we read the book first.
And we did that first. And there's absolutely no question in our minds that he's guilty.
The book is pretty positive about that, yeah.
And then you watch the shows and you say, well, wait a minute. Maybe there's something else going on here.
Right. So then you dig a little deeper.
But I'm still thinking that there's nobody else that would have done it.
Well, that's the common sense idea about it, is it was probably him. Who else had any reason to kill her?
You go back to what's the most logical explanation.
Right.
And that's him.
Which doesn't make a conviction.
I know.
We have to be honest about that.
The fact that we think that the most likely scenario is that he killed his wife doesn't mean it is enough to get a conviction.
Right. So he might be free now. They might not take it back to court.
That's
haven't
true.
Heard if they're going to have him go through it again. And I would agree that the evidence is not super compelling.
Well, no, it isn't. I mean, it's basically all circumstantial stuff that really points to him.
All right. So the next one is by another guy named David, talking about David, commenting on sympathy for the devil. David really thinks that David Temple's guilty, just to pre-warn anyone listening.
Okay.
If you're sympathetic for David Temple, this David is not. Driving your sick child around town to the park to purchase 2 drinks, go to 2 stores with no car seat, yes, he's guilty. It's so sad and tragic. She didn't deserve to die, nor her unborn baby. It disgusts me to no end that Heather was allowed to raise David and Belinda's son, Evan. I can't even imagine him having to identify being raised by the slut, these are David's words, that his dad was having an illicit affair with, when he sadly killed Evan's mom. The dog, known for being ferocious, the neighbor being unable to enter the home because of the dog, the police being unable to enter the yard in the home because of the dog. The broken glass off to the side all proves the door was open when the glass was shattered. It was a poorly staged robbery. David's motive clearly defined he was in love with Heather and told her just days prior to the murder any unknown person in the yard. No one takes a sick kid out and about. Sick kids are not super pleasant shopping or playing companions. 3. 6 days before the murder, Heather essentially told David she wasn't happy with the way things were going, the relationship, and was going to end the relationship. And his alleged response to her was, "Okie dokie, I understand." Sure it was. He was cavorting with her within about 5 minutes of burying his wife. But he was cool with her calling things off? No. Not buying what she's selling. As an aside, what a vapid whore she is. Are you so desperate for attention? Married men are the only people capable of filling the void? No shame. I think David wanted out to be with his skank of a side piece. I think he committed a crime with just enough luck he's only tied to it circumstantially for now. As far as the notion David isn't as bad as he was portrayed, a pinky swear from extended family claiming he's just misunderstood doesn't cut it. He may not be found guilty of murder yet, but it doesn't take a rocket scientist to see he's guilty of being a total piece of shit. Another aside, had he treated some women, myself included, the way he treated his wife, there would be reason to have sympathy for him, I assure you. I had the same feeling after watching reading this case elsewhere. I'll try to do more homework on it when I can. At the end of the day, an innocent woman and child are dead. A son is without a mom, a family without their loved one. Speaking of family, I'd be interested to know how much time Belinda's family got to spend with Evan. I can guess. It's tragic. As a mom, it breaks my heart for multiple reasons. It's refreshing, though, to see how thoughtful David was in terms of moving on and how hard he works to keep Belinda's memory alive. A little sarcasm there. That's right. He wasn't and he doesn't. Great guy. Just remember, there aren't copious amounts of perfect crimes. Hopefully, whomever did this looks over their shoulder every day of their sad, pathetic life until the truth catches up with them. Thanks, Kara.
Good letter.
Yeah.
I mean, she's said the same things that other people have said.
Yeah, can I just say one thing about Heather?
Sure.
I think that we're all very quick to make Heather into the bad guy, as you say. And sure, her behavior wasn't perfect, but she wasn't the one that was married, and she's not the one who killed her. So it's more David's fault than hers.
Well, I could agree with that. My difficulty with her is that she knew he was a married man, and she still was having a relationship with him. And
and she knew that his wife was pregnant.
Right, and that's not a nice thing to do.
No, it's not. So. But it doesn't make her a criminal.
No, it doesn't.
And as far as we know, she did a good job raising Evan. Now, if
you're real stout, I'm going to sound like a broken record because I think I've been doing a lot of these lately. But just to remind people, the Russian Imperial Stout is the king, or if you want, queen of stouts. It was originally brewed for the Tsar of Russia to impress him. They tend to be highly alcoholic. They have a roasted, burnt, or chocolate malt aroma, chocolate or coffee taste, dark fruit, and hops are generally pretty quiet. Now, this particular one, Old Bow and Luke, is a chestnut brown color with a frothy tan head that sticks around for a while. It has an aroma of smoked wood, whiskey, and cocoa, and the taste follows the nose quite well. Smoked wood, chocolate, whiskey, a little bit of vanilla. This is a full-bodied beer. The whiskey is kind of prominent, so if you don't particularly care for alcohol, maybe don't go with this one.
Okay, I think most beer drinkers have some enjoyment of alcohol.
Yeah.
To some extent.
You don't want it taking over the whole taste.
Does this do that?
No, I don't think it does, but it's definitely noticeable.
Okay.
It's a good beer.
All right, well, let's open it up. I'm anxious to taste that.
Okay.
Okay, let's take that beer down to the quiet end.
You got it. You know, people are back to normal down there. I was enjoying the costumes from last week.
Yes.
But now it's back to the normalcy.
Okay. Yeah, a little bit drab, honestly, but...
Yeah, but that's us.
That's us. Okay. All right.
Okay, let's start. So the multiple murders in a prominent Southern family began with the romance of Susan Sharp Newsom and Tom Lynch. Now, Susie was a beautiful, intelligent woman who came from one of the most respected families in North Carolina, the Sharp family. Her namesake and aunt, Susan M. Sharp, was the first woman in the whole country to be elected to be the head of a state Supreme Court. Big time
stuff.
That's
right. She was really an important person in the area. A lot of power, really.
Yes. So she was one of the most respected women in all of America. Now, growing up, Susie was considered to be a spoiled brat by most of the people who met her. Everything had to be her way. Now, as a child, she had such terrible temper tantrums that her mother used to put her in a cold shower to calm her down.
Well, I don't know how appropriate that is.
That's kind of cruel punishment, isn't it?
It seems a little dysfunctional, to be honest with you.
I think so, too.
Yeah.
So Susie went to college at Wake Forest, where she met Tom. Now, Tom came from a prosperous family in Kentucky.
Right, but they were kind of new money, where Susie was old money.
Susie was old money. Tom was new money in the sense that his father had a great job.
Podcast feed. And we're in the midst of covering honeymoon murders, or as we call them, honeymoon misadventures. In September, we covered the disappearance of George Smith on his honeymoon on a cruise ship. Our October case was Annie Dewani, who was killed by a carjacker in 2010 while on her honeymoon in South Africa. Now, with that one, there was some evidence that her new husband was the mastermind behind the killing. While a lot of family secrets were revealed, Shren Dewani, her husband, was acquitted of her murder. Now, Annie's family feels that justice wasn't served in this case. Now, our most popular recommendation for a honeymoon murder is the case of Tina Watson. Now, Tina was on her honeymoon in Australia when she died scuba diving. Her husband was suspected of murdering her, and he went to trial. He was almost tried in Australia and the U.S., but that kind of came to an end. Anyway, not to give too much away, we're interviewing Michael McFadden, an Australian scuba diver who was slated to testify for Tina's husband Gabe in his murder trial in the U.S., but then it turned out they didn't need him. So we've built a good collection of these members-only podcasts, and if you join TieGrabber today, you can download them all and have yourself a little True Crime Brewery binge. We're proud of them. They turned out nicely.
I like them.
We put a lot of effort in. Now, joining is very easy. Just go to TieGrabber.com. You can sign up. Or if you don't want to sign up that way, you can also support us on Patreon and listen to these members-only episodes there as a patron. Now, you can also support us in another way, which is completely free. The next time you shop on Amazon, just go into Amazon through our link on TieGrabber.com before you start shopping. So this is a really great way to support the podcast. If you have feedback for us, you can contact us at TrueCrimeBrewery@TieGrabber.com, on Twitter at TieGrabberPods, on our Instagram or on Facebook. Now, we also have a Facebook discussion page where you can share suggestions or comments that we will be happy to share on one of our upcoming episodes. Now, we really do appreciate all of our listeners, and I want you to know that I do read all of your feedback, and I try to get to the topic that you've brought up on every show. Even if I don't get to your letter, I will get to someone's letter who brought it up before you. I try and go with the first person, first come, first serve. Thank you so much for all of you who support us and listen to us each week. And one more little request, if you have a few spare minutes, please give us a 5-star review on iTunes if you like us and tell your friends about our podcast. So that takes care of the self-promotion portion, and Dick has a little something to share.
I have one more monetary promotion.
Okay.
From Mathnesium. But remember, every child has their own unique learning style, especially when it comes to math. Mathnasium is the leading math-only learning center that is committed to the belief that a fundamental understanding of math can boost any child's success in school.
And rightly so. Now, the boys were very secretive on the phone, and they were getting conflicting stories from them. Tom was afraid that Fritz was going to kill the boys with his doctoring.
Yeah, because he's plying them with vitamins, he's giving them shots.
Yeah.
There was one occasion where he had cut off moles or something on their faces.
Oh, Jesus.
I mean, Fritz is nuts.
Yeah, he is.
No one in the family realized that Susie and Fritz were calling each other husband and wife. They were keeping that a secret.
Yeah, but around their neighbors they did, right? They told them.
The neighbors all assumed they were married. But they were pretty much loners. They kept to themselves.
Well, that doesn't surprise me, considering what's going on there.
Right. I mean, we're descending more and more into paranoia, and they're just not being open with anybody.
Right, right.
So Fritz referred to Susie as his wife and the boys as his sons whenever they were out socially. And he asked the boys to call him Papa.
Now, Susie's apartment is starting to resemble the Klinner house at this point. It's cluttered and dirty. Camouflage sheets were hung over all the windows, so it's dark. And Fritz slept most of the day, as Susie did continue to attend classes and do well, getting her master's degree in business administration.
She was doing quite well in school, from what we
read. She's a smart woman. Yeah.
She's a very intelligent woman.
But he's still presenting himself as a doctor and offering medical advice to strangers. Now, Fritz was a regular customer at the local Kroger store, which was open 24 hours, and he usually shopped there after midnight. He was wearing camouflage fatigues or a doctor's coat with a stethoscope in the pocket. Now, he often spent time on the payphone out front. He bought rubbing alcohol, boxes of gauze and medical tape, and massive amounts of vitamins. Now, one night, Fritz became agitated when the total of the customer in front of him came to $6.66.
Oh, the mark of the beast.
That made him really upset, right?
Well, yeah, Armageddon is here.
Right. So people at Kroger are starting to wonder, is this guy really a doctor? And why is he buying all these vitamins and medical supplies here at the grocery store? And now he's freaking out over the 666.
That is true.
So he said that those numbers represented the mark of the beast, and he started talking then about the Battle of Armageddon. He actually said, "Before I'll take the mark of the beast, I'll take my wife and two children, and we'll go so far back in the mountains that not even the devil can find us."
This is nuts.
Now, in the late fall, Fritz began to go to the Army surplus store about once a week or even more, and he told the owner that he'd taken over his father's medical practice. Now he bought knives, canteens, sleeping bags, food rations, and camouflage material. He never looked at the prices, so price was no object, I guess. And he bought books, mostly military.
The cases. And Valerie says, "I studied with Rob and some other awesome and notable people as a student in his Master of Arts Forensic Linguistics program at Hofstra." So here we got someone who's got firsthand knowledge. I always like that. "I went back to school at age 44 thanks to that awesome program. I was part of the third cohort to be admitted. It's the first and still only, I think, program of its kind in the United States, and it's fascinating. I'd be thrilled to talk to you more about it. Google forensic linguistics for a better idea of the basics." And there's also some good YouTube videos. So, Valerie, I think we should be using you as a source sometimes.
Well, yeah, I can't wait to look into that. I mean,
we're going to keep you in mind, girl.
Forensics linguistics. That sounds interesting.
Absolutely. So, and then I have another note from A Killer in the Family by Alana. "What a sad case. I never heard of it before. I plan to read The Evil Within. I feel so badly for the father and stepmother. And kudos for your reasonable defense of your comments about Russell Williams' wife." That was the officer in a psychopath episode.
Yeah, it's been a big thing.
This
was
after
we
got taken
wife.
The task.
Yeah.
So Alana says, "You're both good for retracting, rewording some of your comments if warranted when challenged. She agrees with your take on his wife." And then she goes on to say, "The Blagg case is a very good one. Detectives and volunteers spent weeks and found the wife in a landfill, but the daughter was too small to locate."
Yeah, that we've gotten another email about. That's a case we're going to do.
We are doing that one.
Yeah, thank you, Alana. Alana writes to us a lot, and she's always got some great stuff to say.
She has some good insights into things.
Yeah, she does. Okay, so our last letter is from MSVic66, and this is regarding the suggestion that we cover the Candy Montgomery case. "Yes, do the Candy Montgomery case. She definitely did it. She admitted as much, but her attorney used the excuse that the woman attacked her first, and because of her being so repressed, she flipped out and killed the woman in the woman's own house with an axe. She even took a shower afterwards in the woman's shower. Yeah, she was repressed. That's why she approached her friend's husband for sex. Total miscarriage of justice. She should still be in prison. It's a fascinating case. There's a documentary on it from that old show from Court TV. You have to pay a small amount for that one, however, to see it on YouTube. Also, there's a movie called A Killing in a Small Town with Barbara Hershey playing Candy and Brian Dennehy as her attorney.
That might be fun
that
to watch,
sounds
huh?
great, yeah. The movie pretty much paints Candy as the poor repressed woman who flipped out, but I don't believe it. Also, ID had an episode on it from that show that
Susan Sharp Newsom and Tom Lynch. Now, Susie was a beautiful, intelligent woman who came from one of the most respected families in North Carolina, the Sharp family. Her namesake and aunt, Susan M. Sharp, was the first woman in the whole country to be elected to be the head of a state Supreme Court. Big time
stuff.
That's
right. She was really an important person in the area. A lot of power, really.
Yes. So she was one of the most respected women in all of America. Now, growing up, Susie was considered to be a spoiled brat by most of the people who met her. Everything had to be her way. Now, as a child, she had such terrible temper tantrums that her mother used to put her in a cold shower to calm her down.
Well, I don't know how appropriate that is.
That's kind of cruel punishment, isn't it?
It seems a little dysfunctional, to be honest with you.
I think so, too.
Yeah.
So Susie went to college at Wake Forest, where she met Tom. Now, Tom came from a prosperous family in Kentucky.
Right, but they were kind of new money, where Susie was old money.
Susie was old money. Tom was new money in a sense that his father had a great job with General Electric.
Yeah.
And had risen through the ranks.
So it was only a couple generations with that family.
Right.
Yeah.
Now, Tom was a pre-med student with a basketball scholarship. I guess he was quite the ball player.
You know, good enough for that, but not anything like he's going to be professional or anything.
No.
No.
And he didn't have any illusions about being a pro basketball player.
I don't think so. I think it was a way to get to college. He wanted to be a doctor, right?
He did. Now, Tom was 2 years younger than Susie, and he was pretty laid back and a good athlete. So it's kind of an opposite from Susie. And she certainly wasn't laid back.
No.
And he was handsome, but more importantly to Susie, he is going to be a doctor.
Sure.
Now, I'm thinking there's already some difficulty here, because Susie's an intelligent woman. Why is she just intent on marrying somebody who's going to be a doctor for the status? I mean, I would think she'd be looking to establish her own self.
Well, she did that as well, though. I think she just
eventually
wanted to be paired up with someone successful.
She certainly did. So Tom, he's pretty flattered by all her attention. I mean, he's a couple of years younger than her, so he's got this hot-looking upperclassman going out with him.
Well, she was beautiful.
She was. And she was also inexperienced at romance, and Tom was her first real boyfriend. And while he seemed nice, his ambitions didn't seem nearly as high as Susie's, and a lot of people wondered if they were a good match.
Yeah, especially those who knew Susie really well, from her side, right?
Right.
Now, when Tom introduced Susie to his mother, Dolores, Dolores didn't care for her. She told her friends that Susie was snooty and pretentious. And after Tom proposed, Dolores tried to talk him out.
He went through the same process.
Right. There's no doubt David Temple treated his wife atrociously, and his actions on the day of the murder are a bit suspect. I'd be really interested to hear anybody else's take on this really heartbreaking case. And I have a couple more about this case also. This was a popular feedback case.
It seems to be a popular case for the feedback aspect.
Yeah.
What else you got, or do you want me to do some?
Do you have any comments on Yvonne's, other than we went through the same thing when we watched the shows?
No, I think we did the same stuff. I mean, if you read the book.
Yeah, we read the book first.
And we did that first, and there's absolutely no question in our minds that he's guilty.
The book is pretty positive about that, yeah.
And then you watch the shows, and you say, well, wait a minute, maybe there's something else going on here.
Right. So then you dig a little deeper.
But I'm still thinking that there's nobody else that would have done it.
Well, that's the common sense idea about it, is it was probably him. Who else had any reason to kill her?
You go back to what's the most logical explanation.
Right.
And that's him.
Which doesn't make a conviction.
I know.
We have to be honest about that.
The fact that we think that the most likely scenario is that he killed his wife doesn't mean it is enough to get a conviction.
Right. So he might be free now. They might not take it back to court.
We haven't heard
if they're going to have him go through it again. And I would agree that the evidence is not super compelling.
Well, no, it isn't. I mean, it's basically all circumstantial stuff that really points to him.
All right, so the next one is by another guy named David, talking about David, commenting on sympathy for the devil. David really thinks that David Temple's guilty, just to pre-warn anyone listening. Okay. If you're sympathetic for David Temple, this David is not. Driving your sick child around town to the park to purchase two drinks, go to two stores with no car seat, yes, he's guilty. It's so sad and tragic. She didn't deserve to die, nor her unborn baby. It disgusts me to no end that Heather was allowed to raise David and Belinda's son, Evan. I can't even imagine him having to identify being raised by the slut, these are David's words, that his dad was having an illicit affair with when he sadly killed Evan's mom. The dog, known for being ferocious, the neighbor being unable to enter the home because of the dog, the police being unable to enter the yard and the home because of the dog, the broken glass off to the side, all proves the door was open when the glass was shattered, it was a poorly staged robbery. David's motive clearly defined he was in love with Heather and told her just days prior to the murder he wanted to spend his life with her. The terrible treatment of his pregnant wife and unborn child, taking a sick child to at least three stops, four if you believe that he went to a park, using no car seat for the child.
Going above and beyond eliminating witnesses.
I know, right?
Holy cow.
Sounds bad. But yeah, thank you, Snoopy.
Okay, I'm up. I got a note from Doreen concerning men who murder their wives or girlfriends.
This is a very insightful one.
We have that as a recurring topic, don't we?
We do. We like that as a topic.
And this is a great letter. So I appreciate how many of your episodes are about murders committed by family members and in relationships. To me, these are the cases which fascinate me with the intricacies of interpersonal relationships and joys and pains, which most of us can relate to from our own life experiences. And we would only echo that, I think.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's what fascinates us.
That's true.
Doreen says, I recently read an article in a psychology journal about the profile of murderers who kill intimate partners and family members and how they have a significantly different psychological and forensic profile from murderers who kill people they don't know. I think so.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's definitely in the research.
The latest knowledge about murderers who commit spontaneous domestic homicide, emotionally driven crimes, is being researched to enable early intervention to prevent these homicides. And as you know, 1/3 of all women murdered in the United States are killed by their male partners.
And it's even higher for pregnant women. We've learned that.
We've learned that, but I'm amazed. 1/3?
Absolutely.
Wow.
I'm surprised it's not more, actually.
So one important thing to note, intimate partners and family members need to recognize that they are in risk of harm and remove themselves from the situation early on. Of course, this is a difficult thing. Well, time and again, we've seen that in the stuff we've discussed. But if we could learn to recognize early warning signs like possessiveness, jealousy, narcissism, women could leave men before they become abusive to the point of danger. In other words, after a few dates. Yeah, don't even marry the guy or live with the guy.
Well, I think that's when you could probably get away safely, right? Once you get really involved and they've honed in on you.
Yeah.
Well, it's really almost impossible to leave.
And as Doreen says, I mean, once you're in deep into the relationship, it gets really difficult to extricate yourself.
Absolutely. I mean, that's when people start saying, why didn't she leave? And we know absolutely why, because when you leave and you're deeply into a relationship with someone like that,
yeah,
you're at very high risk to be killed.
Yeah. So I like her thoughts. A few dates.
Yes.
Before you get too involved.
Because you know.
Involved.
I think for the most part, you know. There might be cases where you don't, but I feel like within two or three dates, you know if you're with someone that you shouldn't be.
Yeah. I think that while you're dating is the perfect time to assess the psychological makeup of your prospective mate.